Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent? Our first item of business is to decide to take item 7 in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. Our second item of business this morning is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and we have 90 minutes scheduled for this session. And I welcome to the meeting Marie Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and her officials, George Burgess, the Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy, and Annabel Turpey, the Director of Marine Scotland. We're going to kick off straight away with some of the questions around the Agri Bill. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for an update on where we are exactly with that and when we expect the introduction of the bill?
Yes, the committee will be aware that we had a consultation on proposals for a future agriculture bill, which closed in December last year. We've been analysing the consultation results and will be in a position to publish the response to that consultation shortly. I've outlined previously, and we have a commitment to introduce an agriculture bill to the Parliament this year, and we're still on track to deliver that.
Thank you. Alan.
Thank you. I was going to ask about the timetable regarding amendments to the Agriculture Retained EU Law and Data Scotland Act, not to be confused with the other rural bill, I'm sure. But given the ping-pong going on with legislation in Westminster just now, I wonder if you could just explain the two bills, or particularly the agriculture bill and its relevance.
So in relation to that, would this be the amendments that we need and the transitional amendments that we need for the current schemes? Yes, we'll be introducing, as I said in my initial response, the Agriculture Bill this year. We also published earlier this year our roadmap to reform and when we'd be looking to, first of all, introduce conditions in 2025 and then when we would be phasing the transition to the new framework beyond that and over the years from 2025 onwards. So we need to bring forward legislation to extend the provisions in the Agriculture Act 2020. I'm not able to give a definitive timescale for that at the moment, but we need that transitionary piece of legislation to allow us to continue on with the various schemes that we have at the moment so that we can ultimately implement the roadmap that we've set out.
Thank you.
But I will, of course, keep the committee engaged and informed as we look to introduce that.
Yeah, just back to the agricultural bill, it would be helpful to get a clear indication in just this year, given the tight timescales we're going to be working to get a new system in place. Can you be any more accurate or clearer on what this year means?
Ultimately, I've said that we would publish it this year, but I hope you can appreciate that, you know, in relation to the ministerial code, it's not possible for me to give a definitive date until all of that has been agreed by Cabinet and until that's been discussed with the Parliament as well. So I can't give a definitive date as to when that's going to be introduced, but of course we intend to do that as soon as we can.
Okay, thank you. Just on that, we've heard some farming sectors calling for 80% of the funding to be to base payments. Can you tell us what your position is on that? And also around conditionality, can you give us some examples of what conditionality might be applied to payments in Pillar 1?
Again, we do hope to, in line with what we published in our roadmap, it set out the information as to when we would be looking to publish information on conditionality, which, again, we hope to be in a position to do very soon. It also set out some of the areas that we could be potentially looking to do that in as well, whether that's in relation to BPS, looking at greening, the GEIC requirements that are there, looking at cross-compliance, potentially elements of a whole farm plan. That was all listed in the information that we published. And we also mentioned there about potential conditions for voluntary coupled support as well. But again, in line with what we've published in the roadmap, we will be announcing the detail of that shortly. But sorry, apologies, just to come back to the first part of your question as well in relation to the NFUS calls and the budget splits. Of course, these discussions are ongoing. I know that that's NFUS NPS's position, there are also other areas, other bodies who have very different views on that. We've committed to a policy of co-development in relation to how we develop our agriculture policy going forward. So, of course, we'll be continuing those discussions with the Areal Board, with NFUS and our other stakeholders as well before setting out a position.
OK. Is it likely that conditionality and some of the examples you've given will be on the face of the bill, or will that be introduced after a bill is passed?
That conditionality wouldn't be on the face of the bill, and as I've outlined in my response to Alistair Allen, that's where we need that transitional provision using the powers within the current Act to allow for that conditionality and that continuity going forward, so we can deliver what we've set out in that roadmap.
But given how important conditionality might be, we could, as MSPs, be asked to vote on an agriculture bill which we don't actually know how the payments are going to be made, how much are going to be paid. So we're actually going to be voting blind, given that what is such an important part of the bill, the conditionality on the bulk of the payments, is not going to be decided till after the bill's passed.
But there will be that opportunity for scrutiny going through. I mean, we need a framework piece of legislation, which is what we're bringing forward, to enable us to have that adaptive framework for the future. And that's what we set out in our proposals and what we'll be introducing as part of the bill. Now, of course, we've been working through our consultation responses, so I can't say definitively what's going to be in that at the moment. But the aim would be then for the secondary legislation, which would contain that detail. Now, I understand the calls for clarity, for more detail and for more information. And again, we've set out within the roadmap when that information will become available. And of course, there is going to be the opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny as part of that process too.
OK. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Premier. I'd be, so on kind of the thinking around the payments, I'd be interested to hear. I've got a couple of questions in this area. So one is around supporting farmers who are already or want to grow more fruit and veg or plant protein. And you know, as you know, horticulture uses less land and supports many more livelihoods in rural areas. So I'd be interested to hear what your thinking is in terms of supporting more people to actually grow food in Scotland.
That's what we've set out in our vision. I mean, and I hope that in the debates we've had in Parliament over the course of the past few weeks, we've really emphasised the importance of producing our own food. We set out in our vision for agriculture that we want to produce more and meet more of our own food needs more sustainably, which is exactly what we'd be looking to do as well. So,
specifically in the area of horticulture, what are your thoughts on that?
In relation to horticulture, I mean, it's a vitally important sector to Scotland in terms of the fruit and vegetables we produce. Now, we know there are a number of issues that are affecting the sector at the moment, but of course, it's something that we would want to see, and we would want to encourage to see people to become involved in horticulture going forward. Now, we also have various schemes as well, and I know that there are various projects. I have one in my own a few in my own constituency about that are looking at community supported agriculture as well, and there's been various schemes that we've supported through that, which I think are really important, because all of that is about strengthening our local supply chains and shortening our local supply chains too, which of course also meets the objectives that we want to set out in the Good Food Nation plans that we'll be producing to.
Thanks for that. And I've got another follow-on question, which is more about the less favoured areas. And so I'm getting contact from people who are crofters who are concerned about inflation having an impact on in their less favoured areas with their sheep and cattle farming. And so I think that, you know, one opportunity that we have with the change in policy is the diversification of what they can do. And I'd just be interested to hear if the government is considering, or can you confirm that farmers in less favoured areas will be supported to access funding for projects such as the forestry grant schemes and things like that, so that they can actually diversify?
Yes, and we also want to ensure that the grant schemes that we have at the moment, if there's improvements that can be made, that we are doing that at the same time as well. So the committee will probably be aware that we've had a consultation which just closed within the last couple of weeks about improvements to the forestry grant scheme, what we can do to remove some of the barriers that people face in accessing that. and really trying to overcome that, because we want to see more trees integrated on farms. We have an integrated trees network as well, which we like to direct people to show exactly how that can be done. So of course those kinds of opportunities are really important, but I also just want to emphasise that I recognise how important the less favoured area support that we currently provide is. That's why we've committed to maintaining those level of payments as they are at the moment, but we also know the importance of that kind of support going forward. So that's work we'll be continuing to do as we've set out in our roadmap as we look to build the future framework. George.
Just a brief supplementary point, if I may. An important part of the Agriculture Bill consultation was actually looking to make sure that tenants and crofters are not barred, but because of the nature of their tenure, from participation in schemes, be that sort of environmental schemes, be that other forms of diversification. So certainly something that we would support. And over the last month, it's been the agritourism month, and I think quite a number of MSPs will have seen good examples in their own areas of a form of diversification that is bringing in significant income for holdings.
Thanks very much. Thanks for confirming that.
I've got two brief supplementary from Jim Fairley and Rachel Hamilton. Jim.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm just looking for a go back a wee stage to what the convener was talking about in terms of the conditionality and how that is going to be implemented. And just for folk who maybe aren't as au fait with the system that works, how you get a framework bill and then later legislation. If you've got a framework bill and you set something out in the face of it, well, that becomes the act. If you've got scope then to bring stuff in later to help achieve the objectives, is that why the details and the conditionality have to wait until later? Does that make sense?
Well, we would have the details of the or what the requirements say for Tier 2 within the new legislation. Uh-huh. That would be set out in secondary legislation, the details or the measures to be included within that. And that is ultimately to allow for that flexibility in the future so that we don't have to go back and amend primary legislation every time. And it also means that we can adapt or add or change those measures in relation to if there are innovations in agriculture, as an example. So it provides us with that flexibility and that adaptive framework that we'll need for the future so that we have more flexibility than what we have through the current schemes.
Yeah. So if we put everything right at the start, that would be it fixed, and then you would have to amend primary legislation in order to change anything as things develop.
Yes.
Right. Okay. That's a clarification I was looking for. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Clearly, there is a call to maintain the direct payments in Tier 1 and 2, and the arguments are made on the basis that currently farmers are, looking at efficiencies, they're looking at improving the environment and all the rest of it. I mean, if we get to a stage where we remove that payment without clarity, it means that they cannot plan for the future. We know that, the livestock industry is contracting, and we know that that genetic bank of high quality livestock will never ever be able to be replaced. So what impact study has been done on what you're saying in pushing this down the line so that we look at it beyond primary legislation?
We're not pushing it down the line, though. And I think that, again, what we did with the route map that I published in February was to set out a very clear timescale as to when changes would be introduced, when the information about those changes would also be made available people, exactly to enable them to plan. So that's where it sets out that very clear timetable in relation to that, to try and give that comfort about information. But I would say that we're not removing any payment without clarity. And as I've said before in Chamber, and I'm keen to make that commitment again and to be clear, that we're not going to see any cliff edges when it comes to support and people accessing schemes one day and then they're gone tomorrow. I absolutely appreciate how important this is and for people to be able to plan their future and to plan their business and the need for that longer term clarity and security. But again, that's why we've committed to maintaining direct payments, because we recognise how important that support is for our food production and to enable our farmers and crofters to continue to undertake the good work that we're already doing. So again, we've set out that route map with that clear timetable, saying when more of that information will be available.
Just to be clear and give you an example of where individuals are concerned, I spoke to a group from the islands yesterday. We know how important livestock farming and crofting is in those areas, and particularly less favoured areas. There are suggestions that they are hearing that instead of livestock farming, which is so important to their economic livelihood, that there's suggestions that trees will be planted in, for example, Westray, where they can't grow. So I think the government need to be very clear in terms of the communications around the tiers and around the sustainability of the future for farmers and crofters.
I mean, I don't know where those suggestions have come from, but I'm more than happy to follow up with you on that and to hear those particular concerns. But again, as I set out in the debate last week, I absolutely recognise the importance of livestock farming to our island communities, and there are some parts of the country where there aren't as much opportunities for looking at other measures they could take or other types of farming that they could look to undertake. We've committed, there will still always be a place for livestock farming in Scotland because we do it here and we do it here well, and that's going to continue into the future. So again, I'm more than happy to follow up on those particular issues. And I think if there's, and I do want to be clear in that communication as well, and I think it's frustrating hearing some examples like that because I want to make sure that the messages we are sending out are reaching everyone, which I think if you're hearing those examples, then that's not the case. And I think that if there's any suggestions as to how we can improve our communications, we're looking to do that as much as we possibly can, especially because I think we have so many examples too of the types of, well, we have different networks, our Agriculture Biodiversity Climate Change Network, our Integrating Trees Network, where we're seeing so much good practice undertaken as well. We also have our Farming Advisory Service in relation to that too. We want to make sure that we are looking to engage with as many people as possible. And again, that's what we try to do and provide that more of that clarity and information through the route map and direct people to look at that, as well as the list of measures that we publish to give an indication of what things might look like in the future. And to actively seek that feedback too, because we want to hear that, to hear how these measures might work.
Fairly.
Yeah, thanks, Camilla. Can I say, I want to move on. We had information from you earlier in the year about the National Test Programme. Can you give us an update on where you are at the moment with it?
Yes, I'm more than happy to. In relation to the National Test Programme and track one of that programme, I think the last time I appeared in front of the committee, we were looking at fairly low figures in relation to the carbon audits and soil tests that had been undertaken at that time. And I think I'd said then that, you know, anecdotally we were hearing that, you know, more people were intending to claim. But I think the final figures that we had when that claims window closed, I think we've had over 1,000 tests undertaken. So I think just over just over 500 carbon audits, and then the rest made up with the soil tests that have been claimed as well. And that has meant that I think over £1 million worth in funding had been allocated in relation to that. And then that's not to mention, though, the carbon audits that had already been undertaken via the Farming Advisory Service. And I think we had 500 carbon audits undertaken in relation to that as well. In relation to track two of the programme, we had undertaken a survey, quite a widespread survey. We had about 1,000 responses to that. And that was really to get more of an understanding of the understanding and uptake of sustainable and regenerative practices across the industry. So that was, I think we were quite pleased with the response rate that we had in relation to that. And in relation to that survey as well, I think it found that the majority of people had undertaken an action, whether that's a carbon audit or looking at nutrient management planning. But that survey was also important just to help us identify what the motivations for people undertaking these actions were, as well as looking to identify what barriers or what would be preventing people from undertaking any specific action. So it's been really helpful in that sense and in getting those views back.
So what would those barriers be?
I think some of the key barriers were in relation to knowledge and support, being able to progress with that. I think the access to to funding was also identified as a potential barrier. But George, I don't know if you have any further information to add in relation to that.
I think those are the main points coming out of the survey. What's been happening more recently is more detailed work with a smaller group drawn from the 1,000 that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned. So around 60 of those that responded, there's now detailed one-to-one work with them. So looking at the list of measures that we set out in February, so working through with the individual farmers to say, OK, well, if this is the list of measures, how would this work for you? So that's all feeding back into the design of the scheme. We're also picking up feedback from NFUS and their members. I heard yesterday some quite positive feedback from the arable sector on the list of measures that they are really quite favourable on.
So I'm presuming that you're taking these from across the country?
Yes.
Yes.
So all four corners because of the different topography. Right, OK. Thank you, Kenny.
These figures are quite disappointing. We've got soil testing, what's actually been the outcome from that? Have we seen changes in fertiliser or whatever? When you compare it to Ireland, 41,000 farmers have applied for their lime scheme, which will show almost immediate improvements in soil fertility. Are you disappointed that the schemes at the moment are really not delivering? And can you give us an idea why that's the case?
I mean, I was glad when I saw the figures increase towards the end of the claims window, which I think was what we had heard or what we had been expecting to see. Of course, we want as many people as possible to take the support that is there to undertake these actions. But we also know people already, there are a lot of farmers and crofters who can already undertake soil testing and who undertake carbon audits. So we really are trying to incentivise that as much as possible. Now, it was the first year of the programme, so I hope that, you know, this is a programme that we're running for the next couple of years too, that we'll see that continue to build and see that interest build so that we will see more audits and more tests coming through. And we really want to encourage that because it's about those individual businesses getting their baseline and see where they can make those improvements from there. But that's also why we want to build on the test programme as we go forward as well. So continue that support for the carbon audits and soil testing. But that's why we've added the animal health and welfare plans for this year, the support for that too. And we do hope to also add biodiversity audits to that programme.
Where are we seeing any positive outcomes? Because doing a test, just doing a test, so that's not positive in itself. And giving a farmer a couple of hundred quid to get the vet to come in doesn't do anything. Where are we seeing the positive results? So once again, harping back to Ireland, we see the results of soil testing. We've got 41,000 farmers applied for lime grants to on the back of their testing. So where's the improvements? Because testing is just the first step. Have you done any research into what benefits that's actually resulted in? And the same with animal health tests.
Well, again, those are elements that have only just launched. In terms of the individual the actions that would have been taken on the back of those audits, I mean, those are just the figures that had been claimed up until that point. George, I don't know if you want to come in on that, but I think just before we get to that as well, I absolutely agree with your point. It is all very well undertaking a test. It's about the actions you take on the back of that that are really important. So that's where we've also offered, as part of the soil testing, £250 personal development funding to enable that, to encourage that upside skilling and to enable people to undertake that nutrient management planning. But in relation to, I detect a criticism in relation to the funding that's been offered for animal health and welfare. But that scheme hadn't been designed by us. That was with farmers and crofters, with our chief vet, with our key stakeholders, to look at a package that would incentivise that to happen, not just to undertake a plan, but what are the meaningful actions that will have an impact for these businesses. And that's how that programme was developed. And I believe so far, from the feedback that I've certainly heard, and George, I don't know if you've had more information, but that has been that package of support that's available has been well received.
Yes, and indeed. I mean, there was a meeting of the British Veterinary Association here in the Parliament just a couple of weeks ago, and feedback there was that the response had been good, and I think vets are encouraging their customers to participate in the scheme. On the soil testing, obviously, the impact is for the individual farmer, what they will discover about their soil and their ability to adjust, the amount of lime or fertiliser that they're themselves using. So it's going to be down at that individual scale that the benefits will be seen.
But the policies will be output driven. How are you going to record those positive outputs? Outcomes, I should say, sorry. Positive outcomes. How are you planning to record that?
Well, I think it's also the actions that and the measures that people will be undertaking that will also be critical in relation to that too. But again, that's where some of the measures we've outlined and what we're looking at for potential inclusion as part of a future framework are really important in getting the feedback on that. And again, that's where the track two of the testing programme comes in, because that's about that more detailed and in-depth work with farmers and crofters to see, right, how do these measures work together and how do we see those improvements?
Rachel Hamilton.
Quick point on this, because we've heard in evidence from various members of AREOB and other stakeholders that it's very difficult to work out what the baseline is to then work out what the outcome is in terms of environmental benefit, particularly because farmers have spent, and I made this point to you in the chamber, thousands upon thousands of pounds already meeting these measures, doing the soil testing, spending their own money, because they know that investing in their own money reduces input costs and it increases productivity and efficiency. So how is the government going to ensure that those individuals who have already carried out those measures are being rewarded? And where is the baseline going to start?
I know, I think that's a really important point, and one that I think had been raised a number of times in the debate last week is about that recognition. And I think that's certainly one thing I hear when I'm out and about and visiting different farmers and hearing about the actions they've already undertaken. Now, we know we've got a lot of work to do. We want to initially incentivise those people who haven't undertaken these actions to do that and to get that baseline information. But I think that that is where, I mean, that's fundamental to our thinking and our planning going forward, that we do recognise and reward that work that's already been taken going forward. George.
Yes, I mean, we're very clear that we're not penalising those that have already, as you say, been taking the right action. So many farmers will already have been doing soil testing. They are still eligible to claim through our scheme. It's not like some of the banks who offer the good interest rates only for new customers. Actually, we're making sure that those that are already undertaking the right actions can benefit from what they've already done in the same way that those that we entice into taking these measures.
And good morning to the panel. Can I ask for an update in regards to climate change plans for Scottish agriculture, particularly in terms of the emissions targets, please?
Yes, we are currently, we need to provide an update to the climate change plan and set out our policies for meeting targets. So work's ongoing in relation to that, and I believe the plan is due to be published later this year.
Yeah. Okay. Is the progress on that plan... Is it being derailed in any way, or do you feel that it is progressing in a timely manner and what was expected of it?
It is really challenging in terms of meeting the emissions envelope that we have set out, and I don't think there's any getting around that whatsoever. So obviously we have really stretching targets to meet, that we need to reduce our emissions by, I think, 2.4 megatons of CO2 by 2032. We know from the work that had been undertaken through the farmer-led groups and combining all of those measures together, I think that takes us to a 1 megaton reduction, so we know we've still got that gap to meet. So the challenge is there. It's a challenge we're trying to work through together to see how we can address that and meet that gap. So that's where we are considering what further work we can do or policies we can take forward to enable us to do that.
Okay. Thank you.
Just very, very briefly, and I know it's a topic we've touched on before, the livestock numbers in Scotland. And you know, there was previously consideration or worries that the Scottish Government were going to look at some sort of scheme that would reduce livestock numbers. Can you once again on record say that the Agricultural Act, when it comes into force, will protect the livestock numbers that we currently have and avoid a reduction which might get us closer to that critical mass which would result in a rapid decline in livestock industry in Scotland?
First of all, I would say there is no plan to cull any livestock in Scotland. Again, I said last week that I support our livestock industry. I see a strong role for that, and our livestock industry continuing into the future, because we produce livestock well in Scotland and that will continue. We do not have any policies to actively reduce livestock numbers. Now, I would like to separate that from the point of putting it on the face of a bill, because as I've outlined, what we would be bringing forward in legislation is a framework bill. That wouldn't be the place to put a specific issue or a commitment like that in. So I hope that you can understand that. But I want to be absolutely clear and unequivocal in my comments today in relation to supporting our livestock sector.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Convener. Finding it strange we're talking about Irish agriculture when they're predicting a cull of 200,000 cows. But anyway, can you give us your expectations regarding the future agricultural funding support schemes in the longer term? And do you have long-term security of funding from the UK government, given that they are the source of 96.4% of the funding that comes to agriculture in Scotland?
We don't have that clarity of funding going forward and not beyond 2025, which makes it really difficult to plan. Obviously, we've come from a scheme where we worked to 7-year programmes through the CAP, but right now we're working on yearly budget allocations, which of course makes it really difficult to plan for the future.
Okay. We currently receive, I think it's about 17% of the annual UK budget that's spent on agriculture. There is some concern, or I'm perhaps being confused, that that gets barnetised as this develops. Have you got any indication at all from Treasury of what the level of funding is going to be? And if they did barnetise the funding, what would that mean for the Scottish pot to be able to deliver to Scottish agriculture?
Yeah, I mean, in relation to any discussions, now, when the Bew review was undertaken, there was a commitment within that that there would be that further discussion about future allocations and how that would work. We've continued to pursue that with the UK government since that time to try and have that discussion and, again, discuss what future funding will look like. But despite pressing for that, those discussions have never taken place. But, George, I don't know if you would have anything further to add to that.
As Cabinet Secretary says, there have been no discussions, despite a number of requests for it. I wouldn't want to go down a sort of Barnett formula rabbit hole here, but just maybe a little bit of clarity. The Barnett formula is not about absolute, so it wouldn't be saying, Scotland will get a population-related share of the spending in England. The Barnett formula works on, you know, increments or decreases, so it would be quite a complicated process if that was what the Treasury decided to do. We simply have not had any discussions with Treasury on this, and as the Cabinet Secretary says, the key point is that we simply do not have any clarity on funding beyond the next few years.
Have you tried to have discussions with the UK Treasury on
yes.
whether or not there's going to be future funding?
Yes, we have, and we've raised that repeatedly with the DEFRA's various secretaries of states that we've had throughout that time as well, but as yet there has been no response.
Okay. Johnny Hall told the NFUS in a previous SEAC committee that if we took an Elms-type approach in Scotland funding and we phased out direct support and things such as less favoured area support and more disadvantages, that this would be a death knell for Scottish agriculture. Now, I'm taking from that we're talking about areas like less favoured areas, because we had a different scheme in Scotland to support less favoured areas. Could the UK Internal Market Act then have an issue for the funding that's coming to Scotland if we wanted to adopt a different policy?
That's been the concern through the passing of the Subsidy Control Act, because we felt that that could constrain our ability to create our own bespoke policies in the future. I mean, England have developed the ELM scheme, and I think it's only right and fair that we develop schemes that work for our farmers and crofters in Scotland and that recognise the very distinct and unique challenges that we face here. LFAS was a particular area of concern because we felt that that was one area, because of subsidy control, that could be open to challenge if that was a scheme we decided, or if we decided to continue a similar scheme to that in the future. Now, I believe that there have been some guidance. There has been guidance in relation to agriculture that's been published, but I think we do still have concerns about that. We didn't think that agriculture should have been included in the Subsidy Control Act in the first place. That was unusual for that to be done. I don't think we'd had any of the consultation analysis shared with us as to why that should be included within a subsidy control regime. But I'll pass over to George, who might have more information, particularly on the guidance point too.
Yes, I mean, agriculture is treated differently in terms of subsidy control at World Trade Organization level, at European Union level. So as the Cabinet Secretary says, we simply don't understand the rationale for lumping it in with other sectors in the domestic scheme.
George, can I answer? Would that not concern you that you don't know why they've lumped it in? Given the fact that the funding that comes to agriculture is almost double what the Barnetise system would be, and I know I keep going back to the Barnetise system, but that is generally how cash is generated other than the block grant. So does it not concern you that there's been no explanation as to why that was the approach that the UK government have taken?
It does, and I think as the Cabinet Secretary has said, on a number of occasions we expressed our opposition to that and asked for that justification, but very little has come back by way of justification. And, of course, the Act, the Subsidy Control Act, provides opportunities for individuals to challenge. So, you know, DEFRA might be fine with our proposed schemes, but it would only take one person that can mount a case that, you know, they can't claim, whereas a farmer or crofter in Scotland or Wales can claim, and a challenge could be brought forward. And that adds to the uncertainty.
Right, OK. One final point, Convener. The summit that Rishi Sunak held in No. 10 Downing Street is very welcome, the change in direction that they seem to be having in the UK government from farm to fork. I was incredibly disappointed that you weren't actually invited to that event, given the fact that we are supposed to have a four-nation approach. Was there any reason given as to why you shouldn't have been at a discussion at UK level as to what was going to be happening with the farm industries across the UK?
I just want to clarify. So in relation to that, devolved administration ministers were invited to that consultation, to the event, at Downing Street. George had been invited to attend, so there was official representation there. But again, it was something that came in at very short notice, I think about a week's notice beforehand as well. And just to say the issues about our involvement in that, given the devolved nature of what was being discussed, is a point that we've raised at the interministerial group and the other devolved administrations have raised as well.
Very last point, Convener. I think it's absolutely vitally important that we get UK government ministers to come to this committee to answer the questions that we continue to raise with the Scottish government and can get no answers because they can't get answers from the UK government. Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you. We can cover the last point, but my question was really about how the Scottish government prepares for the possibility that the UK government really does go in a different direction. Obviously, the Scottish Government is indicating their commitment to active farming in a way that we haven't heard as clearly from the UK Government. So have you any concerns about your direction of policy being undermined by a radically different direction from the UK Government on that point?
I think the concerns broadly relate to the Subsidy Control Act and the measures through that as well, that there could potentially be in the future challenges to policies that we would look to introduce or look to have here, again, recognising the very distinct and unique circumstances that we have in Scotland and how our industry is different to England as an example of that. So I think we're still to see how that develops, but I think it's frustrating that we didn't need to be in this position where agriculture was included, and we had, because we're now in a position where we actually have less freedom and flexibility because of the Subsidy Control Act than what we would have had as members of the EU in designing our own policy. So I think it is one that we will have to carefully consider as we continue to move forward and develop our own policy.
Cabinet Secretary, again, last week in the chamber, John Swinney, following a question from me, said that the £33 million from the BEW funding that he deferred when he was Finance Secretary would be returned to the agricultural rural budget, he didn't give a timescale. He said in future years. Now, we know what Shona Robeson, the finance secretary, said on Thursday with regards to the financial black hole and the pressures facing Scotland in terms of taxation, so cutting spending or increasing taxation. What do you have a timeline that 33 million will be returned by?
I don't have that definitive timeline yet, but I will, of course, be continuing discussions with the Deputy First Minister as to when that would be returned to the portfolio. But I think I just want to be absolutely clear as well that money is ring-fenced. It has to come back to the portfolio. It can't be spent in other areas. So it will be returned to the portfolio, but it's the details on the timeline that are still to be determined.
Just for clarity, because I don't know where this money goes. Has it been allocated to something else but needs to be found again? I don't suppose you'd know that the answer, but it looks to me as though if it's sitting somewhere, it can just come back. But has it been used and it needs to be found and returned?
Yeah, I'll hand over to George who can explain more of the detail in relation to that.
The removal of that money from the RAI portfolio allowed the Scottish Government overall to reduce its spending and achieve a balanced budget. So it's not like the money is sort of sitting in a bank account somewhere, but we have the commitment already expressed by the previous Deputy First Minister and again by the current Deputy First Minister that ring-fence money will return to the portfolio in a future year. Now, our central finance colleagues will have the difficult job to find that within the overall Scottish Government budget to make sure that it comes into the portfolio. Of course, as we've already said, we have no certainty over the funding from the UK beyond 2 years out. So we might come to a point not very far down the line where we really, really need that money to come back in to plug a much larger hole.
OK. That was in a previous financial year, though, so that can't be related.
When is ring fence not ring fence? Because if you've taken 33 million out of a ring fence budget, surely it's not ring fenced.
It helps us, again, as George outlined. I mean, it helps. It's almost like a loan going back to the centre. I don't know if that's the most adequate way to describe it, which must be returned in future years.
So it's not really ring fenced?
It is ring fenced.
It's just not in the budget anymore.
It's different from any other Scottish Government funding which could move from health to education to transport. This money is allocated for agricultural purposes. It can only be spent on agricultural purposes.
But it wasn't. It was taken out of the agriculture budget and spent on something else.
It will come back.
Yeah, but it was, wasn't it? The 33 million was taken out of the budget to be spent on something else.
It was taken out of the budget. It wasn't spent. It, as I was trying to explain earlier, it allowed the overall spending of the Scottish Government to be reduced to hit the limits.
So it was used for something other than the agricultural budget, which would suggest it wasn't ring fenced.
No, it was offered as a saving. It wasn't spent in another area. I think that's what George is trying to make clear.
It's not very clear. Can I ask?
I'd be happy to follow up with more information and to detail that if that's helpful. But it wasn't spent in any other areas. It was offered as a saving.
It was just not in the agricultural budget, even though it was ring fenced. Yeah. Just on this. Just what is exactly we've heard about Barnett formula consequences, and we've heard how different agriculture is in Scotland, and it needs to be viewed differently. What is your ask of the UK government when it comes to spending specifically? Is it 650 million each year infinitum? Is it more than that? Is it inflation linked? What is your specific ask of the Treasury with regards to the agricultural budget? Because if you were certainly unclear what their ask of the Scottish government was regards to that. So actually, what are you asking the UK government for, and how would that money be formulated, if you like?
Well, we'd essentially be asking for our fair share of funding going forward, because we're already facing a shortfall in what we were promised on the back of Brexit, that agriculture funding would be replaced in full, which it hasn't been. So we've got a £93 million shortfall. So we would at least be expecting that.
So you're looking for £720 million?
Again, we would of course welcome more funding from the UK government, but I think that
So this is really, really important. You need to have an ask. Are you going to ask for 800 million this year and next year? You've talked about multi-year funding. How are you going to pull together that ask? Is it 800 million? Is it 900 million? How will you negotiate that? Will it be a ring-fenced? I just need to have a clear in my mind, because we asked the NFU this and they weren't actually clear. They said, well, 650 million, that's fine, more or less. We'll have that next year, but as long as it's multi-year. What are you actually asking the Treasury for? Do you have to put a business plan down for what you foresee the spend in agriculture over the next 5-10 years as, and have them approve it? In which case, that wouldn't suggest that agriculture is devolved. What is your actual ask of the UK Treasury over the next 5 years?
That's the thing. I mean, all these points that you're talking about, it's not as straightforward as going and asking for this, X million pounds in funding. As I've said, we would at least be expecting the previous promises to be fulfilled and for that shortfall that we've got to be addressed. But the whole point is that we need to have that discussion on allocations. We need to go through this.
What's your position?
In the detail. We need to discuss that with the UK government.
No,
I mean, I can't set out
the
committee today a definitive figure, because we need to have the discussion on how these allocations are going to work going forward. But again, we're not even getting that far.
But you've said you've asked for this discussion over and over and over. But what we need to know, and the Scottish farmers need to know, is what your position is. Do you see this as a fixed grant? And how do you come about that? Is it you agree your agricultural policy and you go to the Treasury and say, we need £800 million to fund this? What's your policy going forward? What's your ideal situation? Is it inflation linked? Is it what is it? Because that's completely unclear what your ask of the Treasury is.
I would simply say it's probably not a best way to begin a negotiation by broadcasting what your starting point and your fallback is. So I think it wouldn't be a good thing for us to do at this stage.
I don't think that the farmers in Scotland will think that's a good position. They want to have some sort of clarity. And no, so that you don't have a position on your ideal scenario, whether that's 800 or 900 or a billion going forward. How that would be formulated, how you'd work that out? No.
I think we're getting into questions here. I think, first of all, as George has set out, it's not appropriate for us to discuss right here, right now, what we would be looking to go into that with. But again, I think we've still got the critical points that need to be addressed. The complete lack of clarity, the shortfall that we have so far, which at least needs to be addressed in the interim, and which we would expect to be addressed going forward. And we want to have that discussion about what an allocation would look like for Scotland, as was promised through the Bureau review, which as yet has not been fulfilled and where we are being ignored.
But what clarity are you seeking?
Again, I've already outlined that going forward. I mean, we need to have a clarity and a certainty over what that funding is going to look like, because we can't plan beyond 2025 in terms of budgets or even get an overall figure of what that looks like, which means that we are constrained in what we can do. So initially, we want that clarity. But the most important thing is having that first conversation and taking that forward, which isn't happening.
Alistair.
On that point, presumably it doesn't come down to what you ask for, it comes down to what you're given. Were things simpler when you had a regime of 7-year funding, as used to be the case pre-Brexit?
Yes.
So if you want a 7-year funding, that's one of your asks. So that's one of the things you can ask the Treasury. The next bit is how you're going to formulate your ask. Is it going to be based on environmental schemes? Is it going to be based on production? And how would that be reviewed over a 7-year period? I would have thought that's a fairly straightforward question. What is your position on what your desired outcome might be, rather than waiting for clarity from the UK government? And I don't know how they can base that.
Again, we need to have that conversation going forward. I mean, ultimately, we want to be able to design a system and to be able to fund a system that works for us in Scotland, and not to have those constraints from the UK government.
What constraints?
Again, the ones that we've talked about so far in relation to what we could face, in relation to the potential policy constraints on what we design going forward. We've talked about the multi-annual funding as well. But again, I think you're trying to pin me down on responses that I can't give you today. But okay. The important thing is we need to make sure that we're getting these shortfalls addressed and that we're at least starting to have those conversations, which haven't begun yet.
But it's a bit hypocritical. You can't tell us about the £33 million shortfall, never mind any other shortfalls.
That's not hypocritical at all. And I think you're confusing points which aren't remotely related.
Yeah, certainly.
Language.
I suppose clarity over certainty, and I would suggest the position on the £33 million isn't unlike the uncertainty we get going forward.
I would disagree with that, because £33 million will be returned to the portfolio and must be spent in the portfolio, whereas we don't know what funding will be allocated to the portfolio or how much we will get or when that will come.
Okay, thank you for that. We're going to move on now to forestry and a question from Christine Graham.
Temperature or trees. I'm quite surprised. This is new to me, the whole thing, and I'm surprised to learn that the policy aim is to have 21% of Scotland covered by forest by 2032. I don't know if that'd be terribly popular with lots of people, but I'd like to develop this. Is this going to be Sitka spruce? Because I remember the whole of Galloway just be covered with Sitka spruce. And also, I understand from the Scottish Land Commission, maybe an unintended consequence that has been is increase in land values when this. And if I'm learning as I go and asking things, maybe very stupid, which I'm well known for, is grants have a great deal to do with the criteria in getting grants, a great deal to do with what is planted and where. Now, I appreciate the consultations just concluded this month. Can you give me your thoughts on how the grant system might operate? Maybe it's premature, but how the grant system might operate so we get the kind of trees in the right place that the community and farmers in the main are content with to reach a 21% mm-hmm. target.
And just to say, I mean, I don't think they're stupid points at all. And these are the issues that we're grappling with, because we absolutely do want to see that the right tree in the right place. It's about how we have that mix of obviously supporting a commercial timber industry that we can utilise in Scotland as well. I think that's really important, as well as having that mix with native tree planting as well. So firstly, it's about getting the balance of that right too. We did have, I mean, it's too early for me to talk about what changes might be made to a scheme, given that the consultation on that just closed within the past couple of weeks. I think we had over 200 responses to that. So we'll be analysing that before setting out what changes there could potentially be going forward. But that is really about trying to identify what the barriers are at the moment and how we can support that better integration of trees on farms.
So can you advise, do you agree with me, therefore, that we did things wrong in the 60s, 70s and 80s when large swathes of Galloway, for instance, were planted in Sitka spruce, which wasn't good for the environment, and there was only a sort of boundary of native trees to sort of conceal them. It was really just a great big harvesting crop. Do you agree with me that these days are gone, I hope?
Oh, yeah, well, I think we definitely learn lessons from what's happened in the past as well. And again, it's about getting that mix right. And again, just as you talked about, trying to get the right tree in the right place in relation to that too.
You mentioned the timber industry in Scotland. I thought we'd lost it, actually, because certainly we haven't, Mr Burgess. We've not lost our timber industry. Could you perhaps tell me? Because obviously there are several things that, in my view, forestry, proper afforestation, can do for wildlife, for the climate, but also for industry. Can Mr Burgess perhaps tell me? Is that part of your thinking about how the kind of afforestation that will go ahead?
Yeah, forestry is not my area specifically, but I can
but
think.
But you made I, a case I, when I said that.
No, but I can think of several significant timber businesses in Scotland and progressive, be that in Ayrshire and near Inverness as well. So there is a pretty active timber industry.
Are they processing Sitka spruce or is it other?
They will be processing everything that's available to them.
Thank you.
Just for the record, I know the portfolio has changed somewhat. Can you tell us, Cabinet Secretary, just exactly what your responsibilities are with regards to forestry? Because I know it's not just agroforestry. What your remit?
I've assumed the responsibilities which previously sat with the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, so in relation to peatland, forestry and land reform.
OK, thank you. We now move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Just to ask Cabinet Secretary, can you give us an overview of the work that the Food Security Unit are carrying out?
Yes, I'm happy to, and I'm happy to keep the committee updated with work as that develops going forward as well. So as I outlined in the debate last week, we now have the Food Security Unit within the Scottish Government up and running, and one of the initial pieces of work that they'll be focusing on is really the monitoring of the risks and potential threats to the supply chain. When we had the Food Security and Supply Task Force last year, and reported that was a really useful piece of work because it highlighted where some of those evidence gaps might be, where we need to do further work, and that was a really helpful piece of work in helping to identify how we can then pick up those recommendations, and the Food Security Unit can continue that work going forward. So essentially about monitoring, initially looking to what to try and identify, of course, it's going to be impossible to see what challenges are going to come down the road or what might affect us, but looking at what we can do in the short term, as well as looking to any potential threats that could potentially harm our food security in the future.
I think it would be useful if the committee could have an update as soon as possible on the SWOT analysis of, you know, what's the challenges that are facing our farming and crofting sectors. I think we know why there's been a contraction of the beef herd, for example, down by 12%, I believe. You know, our critical mass is reducing rapidly. We're down to 413,000 cattle, I believe, now. And, you know, we are looking at the contraction of our essential protein source, our essential affordable food source. And so, therefore, personally, what I would like to see the Food Security Unit doing is, first of all, giving, as we've discussed, clarity on the agricultural support, future of the agricultural support scheme. Secondly, letting us know what the risks are within the supply chain. So we know as well that the Scottish Government have reduced funding for abattoirs from £500,000 to £5,000 last year. So, and I've got those figures here if you need those. What is it that the food security is trying to do other than state the obvious?
Okay, I mean, I've outlined the initial piece of work that they'll be taking forward. I think in relation to, and you asked for some specific information as to what they're going to be looking at. Absolutely, and again, I'm happy to come back with further information as to, you asked for some analysis there in relation to the issues they'll be considering. I'm happy to provide that. But you've also talked about specific areas that will, of course, that won't necessarily fall within the remit of the Food Security Unit, but there will be consideration given to that. Like you talked about the clarity on future support schemes. Now, again, we've set out the route map in relation to that. It's not the Food Security Unit's job to provide that information. We will be providing that information going forward as outlined in our route map, which gives the timelines as to when we'll be doing that as well. You mentioned the point about abattoirs and funding there. I would like to, if you could, follow that up with me and send me that further information. I really just want to interrogate the detail of that because I don't know if that's funding from different schemes, and I really want to understand that more. But to say that, I mean, there are also a number of pieces of work going on in other areas. So we're taking forward a pilot in relation to our smallholders, and part of the work that they're taking forward is about abattoirs and about our processing going forward, and that they'll be looking to undertake a survey in relation to that quite soon, because I know that that continues to be an issue. So again, not all of these are specific pieces of work that a food security unit will take forward. Of course, there are links there, and given where the food security unit sits, there will be that crossover. They'll be engaging with colleagues, engaging with wider stakeholders. But there are specific pieces of work there that will be taken forward by other areas.
Again, just to give you an example of the conversation I had with Islanders yesterday, it's really important that the food security unit engages with the the individuals who are responsible for transport within the Scottish Government, because the unreliable ferry services have caused issues of getting livestock to market. And we know that islanders have been having to supplement feeding because of lack of grassland, for example. You know, they're booking their slots way ahead to get the store lambs off the islands to market, and they are being let down by ferries. And so there's animal welfare issues going on in the islands because they can't get their livestock. And it's a hugely, as you've already acknowledged, important aspect to the kind of wider economic benefit to the islands. So I think if there's anything that I see within the Food Security Unit that is not currently transparent to us, is that cross, departmental working.
But I think that also kind of follows on from the committee appearance that I had last week, where we talked about the National Islands Plan as an example of that, because that, I mean, there is a lot of cross-government work goes on, and particularly by islands officials in relating to that. And again, when I've been in Shetland the other week, similar issues in relation to that were raised, and we again liaise with our colleagues across government to ensure that we are trying to tackle these issues as best we can. Sorry, George, you want to come in? No.
Thank you. We're going to move on to Fisheries now. Annabella will be pleased to hear. And a question from Karen Adam.
Thanks, Chair. Can I ask what progress has been made on the 12 action points set out in the future fisheries management strategy?
Yes, I'd be happy to provide. I don't know if you would want me to run through every single action, but we did publish, I would just point committee to the delivery plan that we published last year in relation to each of the actions that had been set out in the future fisheries management strategy, and showing where we are in relation to that and how we intend to deliver against the actions going forward. I think some key pieces of work that I would maybe draw out from that, and some particular examples on which no doubt Annabelle will want to add to at some point. I mean, when you look at the first action from the fisheries management strategy, it talks about, you know, promoting fisheries as a safe career and a career of choice for people. We have funded Seafish, I think, just over £400,000 to help deliver free safety training for our fishing industry. We've spent about £2.1 million in trying to encourage new entrants into the industry as well, and we've funded that through the Marine Fund Scotland. There's been other areas where work has been progressing and it's underway. So the future catching policy is listed as an action within in relation to the strategy. We consulted on that last year, and we are due to be publishing the results of that consultation, and will hopefully be in a position to do that soon. It's been quite a technical consultation, but I think that we will see, when we look to implement these policies, really positive steps forward as well. I know that there's also the actions in there about the resilience and local, and connecting to local and enhancing global markets for our seafood as well. We've published a seafood strategy in relation to that. And when we talk about the importance of our seafood trade and the confidence and resilience within that too, that's where our other policy commitments are relating to the remote electronic monitoring and vessel tracking are important in delivering that too. We had a consultation on remote electronic monitoring again last year. I think we actually launched that at the same time as the future policy consultation. And again, we hope to be in a position to publish the results to that soon. So there have been a number of pieces of work that have been underway.
Yeah, it sounds like there certainly has. Can I ask specifically in terms of strengthening co-management processes, what work's been undergone there?
Yeah, and I think there's actually been more developments since the delivery plan was published in relation to that as well. We talked about strengthening our regional inshore fisheries groups. Mm-hmm. So there's been a refresh of that network. We appointed 6 new chairs there and also extended their reach out to 12 nautical miles. So that's been one development. We've also done a refresh of our fisheries management and conservation group as well, and how that operated. So there's been, and that's that's really about that, bringing all the different stakeholders around the table and trying to move forward in relation to a lot of the key areas and issues that we face. So there's that new group has been established with the terms of reference. It's a hub and spoke model that's being used for that. So we have the main FMAC group, but we also have four subgroups in relation to that as well, which feed in. So we have one on inshore fisheries, there's scallops, fishing and climate change, and the last one has escaped me, but I'm sure Annabel can provide that information as well. So we've taken a refresh of that, a refresh of the regional inshore fisheries groups, and we're hoping to undertake a review of the regional inshore fisheries groups in summer next year, just to see how all of that is operating. Well, sorry, Annabel.
Great, thank you very much. So the four subgroups are inshore fisheries issues, scallop fishing, future catching policy and fisheries and climate change issues. And we're also intend to form one other subgroup which will focus on fisheries management plan. To give an example though of what the Cabinet Secretary has outlined there, the subgroup on the future catching policy is actually going to be very heavily involved in this technically complicated, if not complex, policy area, so that we have expertise there and that we're progressing that forward. And I think that's a really good example. It's met already, it's got terms of reference, and we're planning future catching policy workshops over the summer, which that subgroup will be heavily involved in, because we cannot do this successfully unless we have our stakeholders working with us at the table.
Absolutely, thank you.
Thank you. Could I just ask, is there any planned changes within the structure of Marine Scotland? There's a lot going on with MPAs, HPMAs, international fisheries negotiations. Is there any planned changes within the structure of Marine Scotland?
Yeah. Thank you very much. Yes, we are focusing very hard on how we ourselves adapt to the increasing demands that our people across Scotland, our communities, our marine industries, actually the people of Scotland in terms of how we use marine to, you know, sort of play our bit in addressing the climate change and biodiversity crisis. So we ourselves are looking at how we adapt. So we are moving to more of a project and programme model. So we're very focused on, we deliver lots of services in the Marine Directorate. We do licensing, we do consenting, we provide, I mean, is it, gosh, this year, last year it was £9.7 million worth of science data, you know, spending on whether it's doing our surveys or then the analysis of that. So we deliver services, but we're also really focused on how do we make sure that we can serve the people of Scotland best by bringing people together in teams to deliver our sort of increasingly demanding workload. And one of the advantages of that is that we are making sure that we are bringing together people who have got real expertise and real depth of experience in stakeholder relationships in fisheries management, aquaculture, alongside marine protection. So we're looking at it as a whole and making sure that we're sort of looking at that in the round. It also means that we can be quite fleet of foot when we need to, which is increasingly something that I think we're all experiencing as demands increase. Thank you.
Thank you. It may be helpful for the committee if you could set out just the changes within the historic structure of Marine Scotland, how you see it going forward and how that's going to improve the way that you work with industry. That would be helpful.
I'd very happily do that and sort of send something in writing.
Thank you very much. Ali-Anne Burgess.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I ask how the Scottish Government intends to use marine spatial planning tools such as the National Marine Plan, Regional Marine Planning, to mitigate loss of fishing grounds associated with potential HPMAs and forthcoming inshore fisheries management measures?
Just to outline, I mean, in relation to the National Marine Plan, as it currently exists, there are no spatially explicit measures within that. But I think that in relation to our marine planning, the measures that are outlined in NPF4 and our regional marine plans, I think all of that looks to develop that spatial planning further. We are currently going through the process of developing a new national marine plan, so the NMP2. I believe that there's going to be a national planning forum in relation to that in the next month, where stakeholders can feed into that process. And I know that specific spatial ask is being considered as part of the work that's being taken forward in relation to NMP2, but I don't know if Annabel would want to add further information there.
Great, thank you very much. So not much to add to what the CABSEC has outlined here. Clearly that's Ms McCallan's area of responsibility. Two things. One is, we know that, you know, as we mentioned in FMAC,
working with industries on how we can best strategically engage to join together all the multiple strands of engagement. So we're not discussing these in isolation is really important. And then the second thing is making sure that we've got collective reporting across multiple programmes of work so that we can understand the progress. But we're also, you know, sort of in the, you know, sort of in the future, in the fisheries management strategy delivery, you know, we are going to be bringing forward a consultation on vessel tracking. And that's because we know that it is vitally important that we also increasingly, one, listen to, but two, capture as much data and analysis on fishing patterns at the moment and other industry patterns so that we can make sure that we've got the best socioeconomic analysis into this as well, so that we're looking at things in the round, because clearly we need to look at the environment, we need to look at the community and social impact, and we need to look at the economic and marine impact and industry impact in the round. So we're taking forward a whole suite of things which increase our ability to have really good socioeconomic analysis as well.
Thanks for that. The Creelers and Divers, I hear what you're saying about HPMEs being Ms McCallan's remit, but it is connected. And the Creelers and Divers that I've spoken with all say that they want to protect habitats for fish and shellfish so that fish become more abundant and our seas can support more fishers fishing for more fish. So HPMEs, which are effectively fish nurseries, should be a policy that creelers would naturally support. And I believe that HPMAs, otherwise known as no-take zones, could still attract their support if the surrounding fisheries management measures give creelers sufficient space and protection from the mobile sector. And I'd be looking for your reassurance that the Scottish Government is exploring ways to support low-impact creelers and divers so our inshores can sustain more jobs in fishing, not fewer.
Well, we're looking to, and we will be engaging with all these key sectors as we move forward as well. I mean, obviously, we've had even just recently a number of debates in the Scottish Parliament, like just considering some of the issues that have been raised, and it's really important we take all of that into consideration as well. But I think that's also important that in relation to the networks I've talked about, the refresh of those networks that we've undertaken, I think that's going to be vital going forward so that we can really encourage that working together, that multi lateral engagement as we look to work through some of these issues. Annabelle.
Sorry, I keep on switching my speak button off. I think that I'd like to stress that we want to hear people's ideas. Mm-hmm. You know, the co-production model is very much based on the fact that actually together we've got all the bits of the answer. You know, government alone doesn't have any of the answers, and we've, you know, it would be foolish to suggest that's the case. So I think if there are sort of great ideas that people have, ideas you want to try, analysis that they want to share with us, please, please, please bring it to us, because this is what we want to do. We want to, you know, got an open door policy. We use these stakeholder groups we've got to make sure that we are getting the best ideas that are out there. And, you know, in the sort of the run-up to the HPME consultation, we did 20 events out and about because we want to hear from people about where they've got ideas and, you know, we want to know it. So I would just like to stress that. Thank you.
Just to follow up on that, do you think that people in the sector, but in general, really understand the kind of shifting baseline syndrome in our fisheries and the level of decline that we're facing, and the fact that we've got these legal obligations in terms of managing our fisheries to good environmental status with those indicators, and we understand from some of them, I think it's number 11, that the seabed is severely damaged, and that's one of the reasons why we need to bring in more protections, and that's why it's connected. It's like if we want fishing for the future, we have to bring in those protections. But I get a sense that maybe people don't fully understand that we are actually dealing with, you know, a very degraded situation, that if we don't do anything now, there won't be anything to bring back.
I mean, I think certainly from the engagement that I've had, I mean, I meet a lot of passionate people within each of their sectors who all, of course, greatly value and know the importance of this sustainability of the stocks that they're facing, but all, that they fish and that they catch.
It's not just the stocks, it's also the seabed. That's one of the things is when I bring these things up, it goes to stocks, but the seabed is the critical thing, I think, here in terms of fisheries, in terms of bringing the fish stocks back, in terms of that ecosystem that we need in order to see our waters flourishing.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think, again, that comes back to it. I mean, it's within everybody's best interest to ensure that we have sustainable fisheries going forward. That's what we want to see. That's what the industry wants to see going forward as well. And we are seeing some fantastic pieces of work around our coastline as well, which is being led by fishers themselves. We have a couple of inshore fisheries pilots that are ongoing at the moment, which I think so far are showing us really positive results. There's the mull crab box, and we have one in the Outer Hebrides as well. And I think that always comes down, it comes back to what Annabel was talking about there, about that working together with the different sectors, bringing all these different threads together and seeing how we can really move forward. Because, again, I think everybody appreciates, and that, you know, our seas are changing as well. There's no doubt about that. But I think that we all want to ensure that we have a sustainable sector, sustainable industries going forward. And that's what ultimately we want to try and work together to achieve.
Grant.
I welcome kind of words like co-production and the like, because I know there is real concern, especially around HPMAs, that these are going to be enforced and talked down to people. And it's a wee bit concerning that that is being done by a different department and this is not joined up. So how can we join it up? And how can we make sure co-production works? Because when I'm speaking to people, they are really keen on making sure there are areas that are protected, areas that aren't. They don't want those imposed upon them. They want to be part of making those decisions and making sure that fishing is sustainable. And in a way, a lot has been lost because of that impression. So we need to change that. And I know that creelers and divers are just as concerned as mobile gear boats about this. So how do we involve them all? Because they're not going to come to Edinburgh and knock on your door.
Mm-hmm. If I could go first, apologies if I have sort of given the wrong impression. So Marine Directorate is working on both HPMAs, MPAs, Fisheries Management and FMAC and Aquaculture, etc. It's that we've got the portfolio responsibilities are split. So Ms McCallan leads on HPMAs and MPAs and Ms Goujon leads on Fishing and Aquaculture, but we join up across it. So we are bringing together the people with the expertise to work across this. And one of the things that Ms Goujon and I have been discussing is actually over the summer giving the committee a roadmap which shows how all these things link together. And I think that would be, you know, and I think we've done something in agriculture and that's been an agricultural reform and that's been helpful. So that's a, you know, that would be, if the committee would find that helpful, I would like to do that. Ms Goujon, and we are, you know, we are clearly working through the consultation responses just now, the many consultation responses we've got. And as the FM and Ms McCallan has said, Ms McCallan will be doing a summer tour and I know Ms Goujon is already meeting groups discussing HPMAs, so that, and we will of course be working through FMAC as well. So absolutely, that listening to people is being understood and heard loud and clear.
I'm sorry, I have to disagree with you. I met with a huge number of creelers and trawlers on Monday, and first of all, they say that the phone rings off the hook to Marine Scotland. They never get any reply. They don't feel listened to. And so I think that is an important aspect to, important issue to take forward. And on, I'm so glad that you are defending the industry in terms of sustainability, Cabinet Secretary, because there's so much misinformation out there. What I heard from the fishermen was that they're very concerned about their safety. And if they are displaced, it means that they already have a challenging role to play to go out and get these protein sources, you know, a sustainable protein source to feed our nation. They will be forced to go into areas that are dangerous and they won't even be able to take shelter. So there are a number of issues that need to be worked through here with Marine Scotland, and I implore you to actually listen to people who know what they're talking about. And I hear what you're saying, that you're listening, but actually that is not the case. They were absolutely, they're devastated and they are on their knees. And this committee there's many members on this committee who agree with me.
Oh, sorry, convener. Yeah, just to come in on that point, I mean, if you're saying that people are getting in touch and they're not getting any response, of course, I want to follow that up because that shouldn't be happening. And we have been, again, I've undertaken to meet with some industry representatives. I think I mentioned that in my committee appearance last week as well. I know that the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero is doing the same because we want to do that active engagement and to go out and listen to people. Again, I'm not going to prejudge the outcome or the next steps of the consultation because we are still working through those responses and we'll take that forward. I absolutely appreciate the points, which, again, I've heard about as well, as that the displacement and potential issues that come from that. And, of course, all of that will factor into any decision making as we go forward as well. But again, just coming back to that point, we recognise the importance of the fishing industry, not just to our local, to our coastal communities, our island communities, but also to our wider economy in Scotland. That's why it's an industry we support. You know, we've secured £486 million in our negotiations for our fishers. Annabel talked about some of the figures and I mentioned them too in relation to what we spend on science, how we're trying to encourage new entrants, what we spend in relation to our compliance, about £22 million on that. We are continuing to invest in our industry because we see a role for it now and we want to continue to see a sustainable industry going forward as well, which is why we're continuing to support that and why we also recognise the food security elements and the food production part of that within our blue economy vision as well, because that is critical going forward.
Just bear in mind we're now fast approaching the end of the session. If we could try and keep the questions and answers succinct as possible. Move on to a question from Alistair Allen. Beg your pardon, Alistair.
Thank you, convener. On the subject of fishing, this committee looked at the Clyde Cod seasonal spawn enclosure some time ago. As you all know, Cabinet Secretary, and one of the issues there that we heard about was the likely need or the certain need for VMS and other forms of monitoring. So I wonder if you could say a bit more about what monitoring has taken place there.
Yes, I'll be happy to. Well, there's been work that's been undertaken by scientists within Marine Scotland together with scientists from the University of Strathclyde, initially really looking at the stock assessments there for cod, haddock and for whiting as well. They've been collating the information that we have from scientific surveys as well as the information from the commercial fisheries as well, and with that information they're looking to develop stock assessments, well, quantitative stock assessments in relation to that. So that's the work that's been undergoing in the meantime. Annabel, I don't know if there's anything further you would add to that in relation to the monitoring.
No, but I would just a little bit, which is that obviously over the summer we're going to be engaging with our stakeholders to gather their views into our strategic objectives, and obviously we'll share the analysis when it's at that point when it can be shared. It's been peer reviewed and been through the usual checks.
Well, my other question, I suppose, on that was just to ask for a picture of the timescale. I think there's a 2-year process here, so I wonder what kind of conversations you're having with fishermen. I mean, this is a form of science that fishermen seem to actually be engaged in very well, and you know, VMS monitoring particularly seems to be something with a lot of support. So what kind of engagement are you having with the fishing community about
Well, there will be. You're absolutely right. It's a biennial closure that we've had. So we've had I think that'll be the second closure that we've had now. So just before we introduced the previous one, we had a consultation in the lead up to that. So we will be undertaking another consultation where we'll be having that engagement. I can't set out a definitive timescale on that yet, but that is something we will be looking to do soon. But of course, we'll continue to keep the committee updated on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. And just to go back to a point about misinformation about fisheries, can I refer members of the committee and anybody else who's listening to some excellent papers that the Shetland Fishermen's Association have produced entitled Fishy Falsehoods, one of them on the impact of trawling on the seabed, and they highlight that there's scientific evidence showing that the true impact of trawling on the seabed is much less than the lurid headlines would suggest. But can I go on to my question? Could you outline what you see are the key outcomes and challenges for the Scottish fishing fleet emerging from the latest international fisheries negotiation?
Yes, I'd be happy to. I mean, as I had outlined previously in relation to the fishing opportunities that we've secured, that's about £486 million. But of course, within that, there are changes within the different stocks from previous years too. So I think probably one of the main challenges is in relation to monkfish, which I think has seen a cut of around 30% in relation to the TAC that's been sent for that. So I think it's really keen that we, well, I'm really keen that we work together with the industry and see what, how we better develop the evidence base around that going forward. But I think that while we've had that in monkfish, we've also seen increases in relation to other stocks, which are looking quite strong. So I think in particular, if we look to North Sea cod, North Sea haddock and whiting as well, where we've seen some quite big increases in relation to that. I think the detailed information I'd set out in a letter to committee into January as to what those percentage changes are. But I think that, yeah, we have seen some really good positive moves in relation to some stocks. But again, there are particular areas of challenge in there for some valuable species to us in Scotland.
Pleased to hear you mentioning about monkfish, given the importance and its value to the whitefish fleet. So if more work was done by Marine Scotland to properly assess the monkfish stocks, and that could avoid further quota cuts, would you ensure that the importance of monkfish to Scotland is matched by increased scientific efforts? And I noticed that the Annabel Turpey highlighted earlier on 9.7 million in science data. Is there any intention to increase that?
Just in relation to the scientific efforts, I think particularly in relation to monkfish, I think we absolutely want to work with industry to see how we can better improve that going forward. So, yes, that is exactly what we'll be looking to do.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. We've touched on this already, but the rule bill going through the House of Commons will, of course, touch on, if that's the way to put it, areas of devolved competence, and particularly some that affect food safety and other areas within the interest of this committee. So can I ask what the Scottish Government's expectations are regarding the use of powers that exist within that bill by UK ministers, and particularly the fact that we appear to be in territory where they don't need to obtain consent from the Scottish ministers or Scottish Parliament, rather, about some of these issues. So I wonder if you can just tell us a bit about where that debate has reached as it affects your portfolio.
I'll certainly try to. It's been a bit of a moving feast as it's been progressing through the UK Parliament. So I may turn to George, who can give some more of the specific details there. But the latest position that we're at, so initially we'd started out a position where all retained EU law was intended to be sunset at the end of this year. Now, thankfully, the UK government have changed course from that. Unfortunately, you know, a lot of work had already been undertaken to prepare for that, because that was going to be a very significant challenge. So instead, what they have published is a schedule, I think, of about 500, I think there's 587 instruments on that schedule that they would be looking to sunset towards the end of this year. We had an interministerial group meeting that was on Monday, the 22nd of May, where I was asking the DEFRA Secretary of State at that time what if there would be any further changes to that schedule, what the process would be if there was a disagreement in relation to what was on that. But I think there has been continuing movement, particularly over the course of the past week, in terms of how that work has developed. So I'll hand over to George.
Is this ping pong between the two houses of the UK Parliament we're now talking about?
Yes, and they've been proceeding without... So the process for the legislative consent had been triggered, but the UK government had also said that they would be... carrying on regardless of whether or not they received that confirmation. So I think that's what's frustrating throughout this process as well. And just outline, I think the key concern within all of this, though, is that the bill contains powers. Well, the UK government and the UK government ministers would have the powers to amend or change, revoke pieces of devolved legislation. There's no consent mechanism within that legislation. So that's even though they've got 587 instruments within the schedule, the whole of retained EU law and where that relates to devolved areas is open to them. So we're talking about thousands of pieces of legislation that they would have the power to change up until, I think, 2026.
Thanks. Just on that, what's the Scottish Government's position? How will you engage with the committees that, because this committee and the Net Zero Committee are probably the two committees that will have the bulk of the laws that are either going to be revoked or reviewed or whatever. How are you going to interact with the committees on these pieces of legislation once those pieces of legislation are sitting with the Scottish ministers?
I just want to be clear that we absolutely will do that. I think that's what's been frustrating about the pace that this has been moving. We've been trying to get the answers to those questions so that we can ensure we've got the correct processes in place here. As far as I'm aware, those discussions are ongoing, but George might have more.
There was already some discussion ongoing between the parliamentary authorities and the Scottish Government around the handling of what we expected was going to be a very considerable number of statutory instruments on the original plan to save bits of retained EU law. The change that we've recently seen, as the Cabinet Secretary outlined, to moving to a schedule to the bill that is repealing the 500 plus instruments mean that we will have fewer instruments coming to the Parliament. At this stage, we simply do not know how many those might be. So probably a smaller issue for Scottish Government and the Parliament to deal with, and our efforts in recent weeks have been scrutinising the list of 500 to make sure that there's nothing on that list that would be a problem for us. Most of it, fortunately, does seem to be old, defunct bits of European or domestic legislation, and is not a problem. But we're just making sure that there's nothing that's slipping through.
Okay, thank you. We're going to jump to a question from Rhoda Grant and with a supplement from Beatrice Wishart.
No, thank you, Convener. Just a quick question on crofting reform. We were promised this in the last Parliament, and because of COVID, it slipped. It's really urgent. I mean, it doesn't seem a lot to people, but it's stopping crofting development. Can I ask when it's going to happen and for a guarantee it will happen in this Parliament?
I've made commitments in relation to that. I mean, I'm sure, as I've said, even in relation to the Agriculture Bill, I can't give you a definitive timescale to when any legislation would be introduced. But I think it's, first of all, important to highlight the work that's already been underway, because I do think this is really important. And again, I hear that as well. So I just want to give the committee an assurance on that front. So we've been undertaking work with the Crofting Commission and obviously increased their budget, working with them in relation to that to see how we can start to address some of the issues that they're up against, which I think will hopefully start to improve things in that regard. We re-established the Crofting Bill Group as well. So that was re-established last year. They have had, I think, 10 meetings so far, and there are more meetings planned, and there are all the relevant stakeholders are considered in that. They've been considering some of the key issues that were raised through the previous committee's report on crofting, and I think that there has actually, I know that this was a point that Alistair Allen raised in his contribution in the debate last week, which unfortunately I didn't get a chance to touch on in my summing up as well, but there has actually been I think quite a good degree of consensus in relation to tackling some of those issues as well. So good progress is being made. So I just wanted to give you an assurance on that front that we are progressing, work is progressing well, and that is still the intention. But I will, of course, be happy to keep you and keep the committee updated.
Within this Parliament?
Yes, that's the commitment that we've set out because we realise the importance of these issues.
Thank you. Really on the same subject, but on some of the specifics around it that relate to the wider agricultural policy debate we're having just now, there are, as you've alluded to there, efforts that have been made to identify the problems of the crofting law sump that exists. And as I and many others have pointed out, there are things like the existing right of veto of a single shareholder in a common grazings over environmental and agricultural projects. And there's also, not that I'll list them all, but the other one is obviously the fact that in some places croft tenancies are changing hands for truly ridiculous sums of money that clearly have nothing much to do with agriculture. So some of these specific issues, is the government beginning to give thought to them in advance of any legislation?
Yeah, I think some of these issues are what are being picked up and discussed through the crofting bill group. But I would say that we are, of course, keen to make progress. If there are areas where we can make progress that don't require legislation, that's what we're absolutely looking to do as well. Because I appreciate the points that you've raised there today, as well as during the debate last week. So I just want to assure you that these points are very much in the minds of the bill group and the work that they're doing.
Thank you.
Just to apologise to members, we've run out of time, but there are some topics that we will write to you on, specifically on licensing activities involving animals. You know, the government's position now that we're not going to have a kept animals bill that the Scottish Government may have or may not have been minded to consent to going through Westminster. Also, timescales for proposed...
is to ask also about rescue centres and rehoming centres, because some of them are quite well-meaning but amateur, if that will also be part of it.
Yeah. On that front, that will be part of the consultation going forward, and we'll be looking to announce that and take those licensing proposals in the coming weeks.
Okay, that's helpful. And we're looking for some more information on the recommendations from the programme board and timescales for the proposed Scottish Veterinary Service. And also timescales for commencing substantive sections of the Good Food Nation and where we are with the development of the Good Food Nation and the setting up of the Scottish Food Commission. But we...
just give a very quick response. I know that I wrote to the committee, I think that was in January, with a broad outline for the timetables as to when we'd introduce a Good Food Nation plan and the Commission. We're still working to those timescales. Nothing has changed and nothing has slipped in relation to that. And we will be looking to consult on a draft Good Food Nation plan, hopefully over the course of the coming months.
OK. Thank you very much. I very much appreciate your time this morning. I will... Jim Fairley.
I'd like to raise a point of order. Convener, my colleague Alistair Allen raised a point of order with you earlier on, which you didn't seem to have answered, and that is whether or not your language in accusing the Minister and her official of being hypocrites was appropriate. The fact that the Cabinet Secretary has been extremely generous with her time coming to this committee on multiple occasions, I'd also like to ask you these questions. Have we, as a committee, written to the Secretary of State for Agriculture in Westminster? Have we had a response to that request for her to appear here, and what was that response? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. I think the term hypocritical is not necessarily unparliamentary, given what we were discussing. I think it was a hard line of questioning. I'm comfortable with that. With regards, I'll refer to the response we gave Mr. Fairley last week, which is on record, that we would write to the Minister, the UK Government, after the meeting we had with the Cabinet Secretary. And that's a matter of record that was raised last week. And
have we specifically written to the Minister to ask her to attend our committee, given the number of areas where there is crossover between policies?
Mr. Fairley, maybe if you paid attention, last week we said that we'd had a response from the Cabinet Secretary to say that they weren't able to attend at that time. That is published. It's a matter of public record, so it's on the website. You would have received that correspondence. But last week we also touched on the topic of further information from the UK Government, and the decision was taken a few weeks ago that we would write to the Secretary of State on the back of this meeting we had with the Cabinet Secretary to raise any concerns we had from that. So I think that you'll see that those have both been covered.
So can I clarify? We have written to the Cabinet Secretary, we have written to the Secretary of State.
Mr. Fairley, I think I've already put on record exactly what you've asked. We're now going to suspend this meeting.
I'm not actually clear on what your
response is. This meeting is suspended. Our second item of business this morning is an evidence session. It's consideration of the Animal Byproducts and Animal Health Miscellaneous Fees Scotland Regulations 2023. This instrument is subject to the affirmative procedure. And I welcome back Marie Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and her officials. We have Alistair Douglas, Head of Disease Control Branch, Animal Health and Welfare Division, and Keith White, the Solicitor for the Scottish Government. And invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. And I'm happy to appear before the committee this morning to discuss the legislation that will introduce changes to the Animal and Plant Health Agency fees structure to uplift fees for some statutory services delivered by that organisation on behalf of Scottish ministers and deliver government policy of full cost recovery for those specified schemes. The schemes covered by this instrument being considered by the committee cover animal byproducts, salmonella control programmes, artificial breeding controls, checks on live animals at border control posts and the poultry health scheme for work carried out to allow producers to trade domestically and or internationally. Charges for these services also apply across English and Welsh administrations, and DEFRA and Welsh Government also have a policy of full cost recovery, and they are also looking to introduce legislation to uplift fees for these statutory services. The Animal Health Miscellaneous Fees Amendment and Revocation Scotland Order 2023 amends the Poultry Compartments Fees Scotland Order 2010 by revoking provisions which currently allow value-added tax to be added to fees charged. HM Revenue and Customs have indicated that statutory fees which can only be performed by the Animal and Plant Health Agency are out of scope for VAT, so no VAT is due upon them. ABRIA hasn't been prepared on this occasion because Animal and Plant Health Agency have already carried out engagement with the affected sectors to understand the impact of the planned changes to fees, and affected industry sectors are fully aware that APHA have been moving to full cost recovery for most of these charges and no significant impact on business is anticipated. And I'll end my comments there, Convener, and I'm happy to take any questions the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. I had some concerns around the charges, and I understand you're going for full cost recovery on the charges currently have not been upgraded for some time, but given most are going up by at least 25%, some are doubling, I wonder if you have considered the impact that's going to have on farmers and crofters going forward?
Yes, and that's where, well, there has been a project board which has been overseeing the full cost recovery, and that has, you'll probably be able to tell me what the specific members that are part of that, but stakeholders from each of the administration's areas represented on that as well. So I think they've known this policy is coming, and as I was saying, because of the engagement that's been undertaken by APHA, there's not expected to be a significant impact. We have been overcharging in some areas as well as undercharging in others, but I think that's where the phasing of the charges and the increases for that is also important. So we'll be introducing a 50% uplift this year and increasing that to 100% and looking to the 100% full cost recovery next year too. So phasing that in, I think, and recognising that and not doing it in one fell swoop. I think the only exception to that, I'm sure you'll be corrected if I'm wrong, is in relation to the work at the border control post, where I think that's looking to 100% cost recovery this year.
Okay. And have any producers expressed concern about that, or are they all reasonably relaxed? Is it not a huge part of their...
Certainly, as far as I'm aware, we haven't seen any concerns expressed in relation to that, but I don't know if you've heard any different.
Is that the concerns are really just about the processes, and that's a continual dialogue that goes on with the Animal Plant Health Agency about efficiencies and savings to make the processes streamlined.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Just the fees are calculated using the true cost. However, you know, it's a bit of a coincidence, but we have this coincides with acute inflation, but there is no reference to inflationary rates. Can you expand exactly how the fees were calculated?
Yes, so the full methodology that APHA have developed is going to be published on .gov.uk. I don't have that to hand, but that's something that can be shared with the committee in advance of that publication so that there's that transparency so you can see how that methodology has changed.
Okay, thank you. And is there any implications or impact with regards to engaging with domestic and the difference between domestic and international trade?
I would have to take that question away. I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. Thank you. Any other members' questions? Okay, thank you. We now move on to formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument and invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M08906.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? Content. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative motion. Our next item is consideration of negative SSI, the Animal Health Miscellaneous Fee Amendment and Revocation Scotland Order 2023. Do members wish to make any recommendations on the instrument? No. Okay, we will now suspend the meeting for a 10-minute comfort break. Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session with the Bill team on the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill. And we have approximately 90 minutes scheduled for this session. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting Hugh Digdon, Head of Wildlife Management Unit, Leah Fitzgerald, the team leader from the Wildlife Legislation Team, Sam Turner, the team leader from the Wildlife Management Team, and Norman Munro, the solicitor. I'll kick off with the first question, and it's quite simply, how did the Scottish Government come to the conclusion that a ban on glue traps was more appropriate than licensing, given some concerns we heard in the consultation that it might cause problems within such settings as hospital, schools and hospitality?
Thanks, Convener. I guess what sort of is the primary driver for the government's position on the ban on glue traps is the report from the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, which itself considered that in some detail, the balance of whether some sort of limited use was justified or whether a total ban was the right way to go. And so I think, you know, we were heavily persuaded by that, and we also recognised that there were quite a number of considerable difficulties in trying to operate a licensing scheme when there was no recognised body for the people who would be operating or using glue traps in those sort of circumstances. But I don't know, do you want to add anything further on that, Leah?
Just to add, so we did consider going down the licensing scheme. That was one of the options that we considered. And as Hugh said, one of the primary drivers was animal welfare, but we also were satisfied that there were plenty of other alternatives for rodent control that were satisfactory. We also looked at what was going on in the rest of the UK, listened very closely to the evidence that's been brought forward during the debate in the Welsh Parliament, and also kind of considered the international position. So glue traps are banned abroad, for example, in the Republic of Ireland. So we looked at what was happening there. And we also spoke to professional pest controllers. We contacted all of the local authority pest controllers in Scotland, and the majority that responded indicated they don't actually use glue traps. So taking all of that balance of evidence together, we were content that the option for a complete ban was the best way to go.
OK, thank you. Christine Graham.
Yes, can I say I very much welcome the ban on glue traps, because outright ban, because it's cruelest form of pest control. Can I ask why a similar attitude wasn't taken to the use of snares? Because I think the Animal Welfare Commission may have got this wrong, recommended a ban on the use of snares.
Well, I mean, the first point to say is the issue of snaring is still under consideration. And if we are to bring forward a ban on snaring, that will be, we'll do those provisions in time for a government amendment at stage two. So that is still part of the consideration.
I didn't hear somebody coughed. Wrong to cough, because I couldn't hear the answer. I hear you correctly. It isn't in the bill as laid,
but correct. It
is under serious consideration for stage two as an amendment.
Yes, that's correct.
That would must alert the committee that it would perhaps require to take evidence at stage two, because that's a substantive addition to the bill.
We will certainly make sure that any provision that sets out to ban snaring will be with the public and with stakeholders in good time for evidence to be taken before stage two. I mean, that's a certainty.
Thank you. That's for clarification.
Okay, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Navina. Can I ask you, I looked in some of the responses and there was a pest control business who had responded saying that they have concerns about banning glue traps in food-designated areas. Was that something that was considered?
Yes, I mean, that's clearly is one of the sort of key arguments for retaining some of the use in food production areas, and also, of course, in some sort of health settings as well, in another sort of area. Mm. But as my colleague Leah said, there are other alternative means of rodent control which are used in by other sorts of pest controllers and other local authorities. And we are also envisaging a transition period to allow people to develop those sort of other use and gain expertise in the use of other techniques.
So if you ban the use of them, will you ban the sale of them?
Well, Leo's going to speak on this.
We have a ban on use on the face of the bill. Our belief is that a ban on the sale would engage the Internal Market Act. So we have been under discussions with the UK government, and we'll continue to discuss that with them. But we'd like to be in a position ahead of stage two or stage three to hopefully be able to bring an amendment to ban the sale. But as I said, we need to consider that in conjunction with the UK government and the interplay with that and the Internal Market Act.
Thank you, Convener.
Just on something that Christine Graham touched on, what evidence or what information are you lacking at this moment not to bring in snares on the face of the draft bill, and rather than wait to stage two, which ultimately will reduce this committee's ability to scrutinise the proposals?
Well, as I said, I think this is going to be fairly imminent, a ministerial announcement on the direction that we want to take on the use of snares. We have gathered quite a lot of evidence from, not only from the evidence which has been produced by the likes of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, as Christine Graham mentioned, but we've also been in touch with snaring practitioners through the land management groups. And the sort of piece of evidence that we are still missing, or we are still gathering, is the land management groups talk to us about new developments in the techniques of snaring, a new development that they call humane cable restraints. And, of course, we thought that was an important thing which we needed to take into account. And we also decided then that it would be helpful to seek from them any evidence they may have about empirical evidence on the impact on welfare of the new humane cable restraint. So that's the last piece of that jigsaw. We anticipate getting all of that as a package in front of ministers very shortly and to have some sort of ministerial decision.
OK, so why didn't we just delay the introduction of this bill so it could have been in the face of the draft bill and it would go through the full process? We're only talking about a few weeks.
Well, we had hoped to get the position on snaring ready in time for the introduction of this bill. The introduction of the bill was planned with the parliamentary authorities and our own parliamentary managers. And so we had hoped to be in a position to have the snaring provisions in. But as I say, there were some sort of later developments and additions and new pieces of evidence that we thought were significant that we sought to get before we brought those provisions. We wanted to get to make sure that we were dealing with the full picture.
OK. Rachel Hamilton, then Christine Graham.
Can you follow that up as a process
thing? It's just a process point, not substantive. Given that, I take it the bill's already drafted and ready to go.
It was or it is. I mean, it's now...
Yes. Is it possible for the proposed amendment, which you intend, if happens, to lodge at stage two, to be brought before the committee at stage one, although not in the bill, in order that we can take evidence on that proposed amendment during the stage one consideration, rather than have to seek taking evidence at stage two?
Yes, that is our intention.
Well, that would be helpful, I think.
That is certainly
Convener,
our intention.
I think that would be helpful to us.
Yeah. When you're saying yes, given that we've got recess and 4 weeks' time, when do you think that's likely? Because obviously we've got planning to do and committee sessions around the bill. When will it be available?
Well, I would hope that we would be able to do it before recess, but I'm not 100% certain of that. Sam, do you have any thing on the timing of that?
Yeah, potentially. I wouldn't be able to commit fully to saying that it will definitely be done then, but that's what we're hoping to do.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Just get clarification, Mr. Dignan, on the human cable restraints that you were saying there, that you had information humane from land management. No, I didn't. I said humane. I just wondered whether you had consulted with others on those restraints as well, such as vets.
Well, I think that's the part of the picture that we're trying to get now, is that the land management groups who have said to us that these are a significant new development in snaring, we have asked them, well, what is the empirical evidence that they improve animal welfare outcomes? And that is evidence which is primarily coming from veterinarians.
OK, so you have that?
We have some of it. We have some. The land management groups have said there may be more to come.
OK, and are they supportive?
those groups that are writing in support of it, yes, they are supportive.
Okay.
Thank you, Convener. Again, you've touched on some of this, but on the subject of glue traps, if there are alternatives available, as has been indicated to you, why is the government anticipating a transition period at all?
It's so different. Members of the public will have different methods to use, different professional pest controllers. So it's just to give people time. It's also to give shops time. They're currently selling glue traps just to be able to wind down their stock and to replace it with other methods. So it's just to give people time and also to give us time to publicise it, make people aware of the changes that are coming.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Could I ask, what is the evidence base for justifying the need for additional regulation of grouse moors? Does it establish an ongoing link between grouse moor management and raptor persecution? And why is licensing preferred to other alternatives? What other alternatives did you consider?
Well, I think that this bill and the introduction of a licensing regime is the sort of latest and hopefully last step in a long series of government initiatives to tackle raptor persecution that has been sort of associated with driven grouse moors. So there have been a number of other initiatives over the years. There have been the introduction of vicarious liability, a pesticide disposal scheme. There have been restrictions on general licences. And I think you will be broadly familiar with the history here, where there was a report into the Golden Eagle tags, which had disappeared or stopped sending signals in suspicious circumstances. That report showed that perhaps up to a third of Golden Eagles, tagged Golden Eagles, were disappearing in circumstances that the most likely explanation was wildlife crime. And most of those were on or around grouse moors. So there was a long history of wildlife crime associated with some grouse moor businesses. By no means all, but certainly there was that was a clear association. So we have, as I said, there have been initiatives over in the past, and I think ministers have throughout that period said that we will continue to take steps until this situation is brought to halt, the illegal killing of birds of prey on grouse moors. And so we believe that the licensing scheme, as was recommended by Professor Warity, is perhaps the most effective way of delivering a meaningful sanction and an effective deterrent to wildlife crime on grouse moors. I guess that's really what's brought us to this stage. That's why it's in the bill. I'm not sure if that's answering your question, Mr. Fairley. Mm.
What other alternatives were considered? Because you've had vicarious liability and doing away with poisons, as you've said. Uh-huh. Was there anything other than licensing at this stage? And why did vicarious liability not work?
Well, so if I could just deal with that point first. Why did vicarious liability not work? I don't think we would accept that it didn't work. In fact, we had a presentation in my office from someone from Police Scotland the other day who said, in his opinion, it had worked. It had a serious deterrent effect. But it clearly didn't do the whole job because raptor persecution continued. And I suppose the problem with vicarious liability is it does depend on there being a criminal conviction. And that has been one of the long-running difficulties in this area, the difficulty of securing a criminal conviction where there are very few, if any, witnesses, and there's no victim able to speak up, and these things happen in remote places and so on. So that was a problem with vicarious liability.
So is that burden of proof?
That was the criminal standard of burden of proof, right. Yes, beyond reasonable doubt. It was hard to establish that. It was hard for law enforcement to establish that a particular individual had carried out an act, a criminal act, and to prove that beyond reasonable doubt. Because, as I say, the difficulties with it being in remote locations and there being few witnesses in those sort of circumstances. So, yeah, I mean, there has been, over the period of at least since sort of 2007, a series of escalating measures, really, as the government has sought to tackle this issue. And I think we're now in a position where we think licensing is justified. We recognise it is quite a significant sort of measure to take that has sort of serious and significant impact on a business that loses its licence. I think the next step beyond that would be an outright ban, and we're certainly not contemplating that at present, but that would be the sort of step that we would see, the only step that we would see that would be sort of realistic and practicable after a licensing scheme. So we are hopeful that the licensing scheme will provide that effective deterrent and that meaningful sanction, and I think if it doesn't, we don't know where we'd go beyond that, beyond other than the ban.
Okay, thank you.
Supplementary from Rachel Hamilton, Rhoda Grant and Christine Graham.
You've mentioned the Werity report, but Werity said that licensing should only be introduced if raptor populations had not improved. What evidence do you have to suggest that raptor persecution and grouse moults are connected, but also have the rates of raptor persecution, what evidence, objective evidence, are you basing your assertions on? Because the Golden Eagle project is now 8 years on, it's out of date. So there's 2 points there.
So in terms of the evidence,
connecting grouse moors to raptor persecution.
Well, I mean, as I said earlier, that is a long-term sort of pattern. I think we can look at convictions for raptor crime have been quite often associated with gamekeepers on grouse moors, but I'd say there have not been that many of them, considering there was something like 160 recorded crimes between 2011 and 2021, so 10 years, that 10-year period. But most of those, or a large number of those crimes which involved raptor persecution, the carcasses were found on or around driven grouse moors.
But was there evidence to suggest that what did you use, DNA, or how did you connect them to the grouse moors, or that the persecution happened by somebody that was managing a grouse moor?
Well, as I say, it's a mixture of, first of all, where there were convictions, they were often people convicted were often associated with the grouse moor business. Secondly, carcasses were usually found on or around grouse moor businesses. And thirdly, there is a clear motivation in terms of controlling raptors to protect grouse stocks, to promote the grouse moor business. So I think there was some sort of clear, hard evidential links and some pretty strong circumstantial links. And as I say, the...
Can you provide the committee with that specific evidence so that we can just take a look at... Because I can't see that here in the information that we've got in terms of the wildlife crime report. The number of offences overall doesn't split it into connection with grouse moor, and also the numbers of raptor persecution offences are coming down. So clearly whatever is happening out there is working. But Werity did say to the government in his recommendation that if the populations of raptor persecution had not improved, then a licensing scheme would be appropriate.
Yeah, so we can certainly provide you with more evidence that associates raptor persecution with grouse moor. So I think the sort of thing that I've been talking about, we can provide that in writing for you, and we can itemise that. In terms of...
That would certainly be helpful, because there appears to be a lack of firm evidence on a positive or negative effect from legislation we've had in the past few years since the last substantive report was done, I think, in 2012. So we don't actually know where things are improving or getting worse as a result of the legislation that's been put in place since then, so the increased penalties and so on. So it's not clear that the recommendations in Werity that things are getting worse and that's why we should have a licence scheme, it's not clear that that's actually the situation.
Yeah, well, we can provide you with the evidence, as Ms Hamilton asked for, that says why we believe that raptor persecution has in the past been strongly associated with driven grass moths. We can certainly do that.
And whether it's increased or decreased since 2012.
I'm not sure of the significance of 2012.
12 years ago, sorry, beg your pardon, it's not 2012, 2017.
Since the publication of the Werity report, undoubtedly raptor persecution has improved, and we the government welcomes any reduction in the incidence of crime, but it hasn't gone away. Police Scotland are still recording raptor crime offences, and I think 10 in the last couple of years since the Werity report was published. But in terms of the sort of the statistical link and the sort of proven link, in other words, the link with criminal convictions and grass moth management, we can certainly provide that.
Okay. Rhoda Grant.
Just really a point of clarification. You said that a third of the golden eagle population were disappearing. Is that around grouse moors or a third of the Scottish golden eagle population?
It was a third of the tagged golden eagles. So the assumption is that the people who were doing this were not discriminating in favour of only shooting or killing tagged birds. So, in fact, the assumption would be that they would tend to not take action against a tagged bird if they were able to. So I think we can sort of extrapolate from that. If it's a third of tagged birds, it's probably a third of all birds. And these were golden eagles across the whole of Scotland. But where they were found, the evidence overwhelmingly pointed to an association with driven grouse moths, where they disappeared or where they were found.
Okay. You don't have a map showing those disappearances?
We do. I don't have it in front of me, but we can certainly provide you with that.
Dean Graham.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand. The licence is a terribly important matter here. And to whom can the licence be? The licence goes with the land, I take over an area of land.
Yes.
So to whom is the licence granted? Because many large estates in Scotland are owned by corporate organisations registered abroad, not subject to Scottish jurisdiction. I think I'm asking Mr Munro, I think who's your solicitor, if he'll explain that to me. So how do you ensure there's a breach of the licence, there is somebody to take to court, a named person to take to court, not vicariously?
So the applicant for a licence may be the owner of the land, or it could be somebody acting on their behalf. So it could be somebody who's a groundskeeper or something along those lines, somebody who's acting on behalf of the owner of the land. And in terms of the provisions for if there's an offence that's been committed in connection with the management of the land, there is provision in the bill for a power for the relevant authority to suspend or revoke licences if satisfied that a relevant offence has been committed, and that's by somebody that is in connection with the ownership of the land. So it is not the case that somebody who, a third party, who's unconnected with the land could have committed a relevant offence and then the licence gets revoked. In those circumstances, it's somebody that would need to be connected with the ownership or the management of the land in question.
To complicate things a bit more, land can be owned by several landowners, could be over several estates, in which case who are we looking at the licence to be granted to when you've got multiple owners of the land who are not resident in Scotland? I'm trying to get to having people liable. Who's liable for this? I know that person is.
The person to whom the licence is granted will be set out on the licence itself. So this will be something that is information that's provided to the licensing authority in the application, and then the licence itself will set out to whom the licence has been granted, so that there will be that direct trail, and so it's, there won't be the ambiguity that you've described there.
So it'd be a named person on this licence?
Yeah, could I just...
I'm just trying to understand so that,
I mean, clearly, The key sanction here is the suspension of the licence so that no grouse shooting can take place.
Right.
So that is so, I mean, if it's some shadowy company in the Cayman Islands or something,
yes,
in a way it doesn't matter because the business, the grouse shooting business, will have to stop. The licence will say withdrawal or revocation of the licence means no more grouse shooting on that. And anyone who shoots grouse on that land then would be committing an offence.
But to revoke the licence,
yep.
How do you do that? Do you not need a named party to revoke it?
Because
suspension could be temporary.
To whomever the licence has been granted, it will be revoked. So, I mean, it doesn't really matter...
Where they live. Or whether it's a company in the Bahamas.
They will need to be someone who... The licence holder for that piece of land, they would need to be associated with the management or the ownership of that land. But, you know, in a way, if it was hard to get hold of them, you would still be able to revoke the licence.
Right, so it doesn't matter about service on them or anything like that if you can't do it.
But I think that would be an issue.
The revocation of the licence, as long as there is the ability to provide the reasons for the revocation to the person in question, and there will be an address that's provided as part of the application, so there will be a way to communicate that the revocation has taken place to the person to whom the licence has been granted. So it wouldn't go down the formal route of service, but information about the revocation would still need to be provided.
So I shouldn't have any concerns, just to put it in simple language, I shouldn't have any concerns if it's estates with, say, two or three companies that are registered abroad, you can revoke that licence. There's not going to be problems about intimation or anything like that. You could put it in a newspaper or on the internet or something, but you can revoke it. You don't have to actually serve anything.
If they've been able to apply for it, and provide the information necessary to apply for it, that means that we'll be able to be revoked.
That's fine. I just wanted to clarify that because this is an issue which may come up. Thank you.
That's right.
Just a point of clarification on something that you said, Norman, that there is no need for the regulator to be satisfied that a crime has been committed to revoke a licence. There only needs to be a police investigation for that licence to be revoked. That's what the bill suggests at the moment. Is that correct? Or does the regulator need to be satisfied that a crime has been committed?
So there's varying degrees of which the revocation or suspension could take place. A revocation may only take place where the licensing authority is satisfied that a relevant offence has been committed. In relation to an investigation, it's only possible for a suspension of a licence to happen in those circumstances where the licensing authority deems it appropriate, where the investigation is ongoing. But this is a power, so it would be for the licensing authority to determine, based on the circumstances and the degree of the offence, and as to whether or not it would be appropriate in those circumstances to suspend the licence pending the investigation. But a revocation would not be capable whilst the investigation is ongoing.
So just a straightforward police investigation, someone phones up, there's a dead golden eagle on such and such estate, the police investigate, that would be grounds for the regulator to suspend the licence?
It would be open to the regulator to determine whether or not that is appropriate in the circumstances to suspend the licence in those circumstances.
Which is quite concerning if we've got potentially people who wish to cause disruption to license at particular times of the year. Yeah, I've got.
Is there an appellate procedure if it's suspended?
Yes, there is.
What is that?
It's an application to the sheriff.
So there is a method, I think, in these circumstances,
yes,
to apply to the sheriff,
yes,
to appeal the suspension.
Yes, that's correct.
I just wondered about that. That clarifies that.
Claim on the 12th of August when an estate had bookings, if that then had to go through a process of appealing to the sheriff, that could effectively bring that estate's income to an end for a year. Or
I think it's important to be clear, as Norman said, that it's a power for the licensing authority to do that. It's not an automatic position, and it would be quite clear that it would be dependent on the degree of seriousness of the offence. So a particularly egregious sort of offence where it appeared to be something terrible had happened and it would appear to be unacceptable that the business continued while a police investigation rolled on. That is the sort of circumstance. But the sort of circumstance where you're talking about, I don't think it would occur to the licensing authority to immediately suspend a licence.
Will there be something within the face of the bill to ensure that? Because, as we know, there will almost certainly be vicarious claims of personal persecution.
Yes. Yeah.
Does there not need to be some safeguards within the bill to avoid that happening? Because the damage to an estate could be significant, and to the knock-on effect to those who work in the state and associated businesses.
Well, of course, the licensing authority, Nature Scott, are a public authority. They act reasonably, they're obliged to act reasonably, and they will have their own internal appeal process for any immediate concerns. And then, of course, there are the appeal process to the sheriff, as Norman has set out. I don't think that we need to have something on the face of the bill that requires the licensing authority to act reasonably in these circumstances.
Okay, thanks. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Kenry. You actually asked a chunk of what I was going to pursue there. But there is quite a bit in this next section. It's the basis for licence suspension, revocation and procedural safeguards. So I'm going to go to touch relevant authorities. I'm going to get it on the record. So, relevant offences. I'm going to get it on the record that the relevant offences are those set out in Part 1 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981, Protection of Badgers Act 1992, Part 3 Conservation Natural Habitats Regulations 1994, Section 1 of the Wild Mammals Protection Act 1996, and the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Act 2023. So, what is the justification for different relevant offences listed in the bill in relation to potential suspension or revocation of the Section 16A licences, and in particular those not related to raptor persecution? Why are these included, and what evidence is there linking these offences to grouse moors?
Well, so these offences have been selected and put into here, as they are all potentially offences which could be connected with the management of the grouse moor. So that's not to say they all have been or are regularly, but there are offences here where it is conceivable that they may be committed by someone in order to assist with the management of the grouse moor. So they generally are around protected species that may predate on grouse or grouse eggs, I suppose. That would be one of the sort of...
But why specifically the revocation of a licence on grouse moors for those particular acts? Do these acts not already have fairly stringent penalties for people who perpetrate these acts in the first place? Why would the revocation of a licence be added to that?
Well, as I say, it's about providing an effective and meaningful sanction for those sort of people who will take these sort of actions around the sort of promotion of the grouse shooting business. And it's ensuring that we can react to that in an effective sort of way.
Given the point that the convener just made about vexatious claims and actions by people who have a distinct distrust and dislike of grouse moors, does that seem fair that there's an additional scope of sanction to grouse moors that doesn't apply to other rural businesses?
Well, I'm not sure that the sort of quite how the vexatious claims would work in this sort of circumstance.
If I had a dead sparrowhawk and I wanted to take it to a grouse moor and dump it right in the middle of a grouse moor and then walk upon it and find it quite by chance and report that would be a vexatious action by someone. Mm-hmm. So if somebody did that, that's vexatious. That's somebody deliberately targeting a grouse moor. We have all the other sanctions in the previous issue of relevant offences that I spoke about. So they could, if there was a somebody who was targeting a grouse moor, and it kind of goes back to the previous point about a vexatious claim, if there is a suspension of your business on the 12th of August, that's going to have a real impact. Now, the reason I'm asking is because these are the questions that are going to be probably the main areas of our debate as we bring this bill forward. So I go back to the point, is it fair to add the licensing into these already sanctions that are there? And what would be the methods of ensuring that people were not targeted?
So the licensing authority would have to be satisfied that an offence had been committed and committed by someone on the balance of probabilities that was connected to the management of the grouse moor. So it wouldn't be sufficient to find a mammal that had been illegally killed. You would have to be, or a bird, you would have to be satisfied that there was that connection before they could make a decision to suspend a licence. So, you know, they would be discussing that with Police Scotland, and this is based on the model that is currently operated by Nature Scot for the suspension of general licences. So we're taking an established model which we know works, and again, it'll be the same reasoning that Nature Scot will have to look. So they'll have to look at the body of evidence and what has been presented to them by Police Scotland and to see if they can kind of make that connection. So, no, it won't just be a simple case of, you know, a crime has been committed, that's grounds for a licence to be suspended.
We had similar conversations when we went through the whole Hunting with Dogs Bill. But I think we got to a position there where what we were establishing was that there has to be this good working relationship between Nature Scot and the land managers in order to make sure that type of thing is taken into account as these procedures are going forward. So the bit that slightly concerns me is the suspension of a, not the revocation of a licence, I've got no qualms with revocation, but the suspension of a licence, that slightly concerns me, other than making sure that good relationship exists between Nature Scot and the land managers. Are we doing anything to encourage that?
Yeah, that was one of the recommendations of the Werity report, to you know, foster those relations. So that's something that is ongoing. We work very closely with stakeholders. We have a partnership against wildlife crime, and land management groups are represented on that. So that work is ongoing, and that will continue. And we do generally have good relationships with land managers.
Okay, thank you.
I'm concerned that it's like a double whammy. So if you were to shoot a golden eagle on land that wasn't designated as a grouse moor, you'd get a different penalty than you would if you were on a grouse moor. How does that implication sit with the European Court of Human Rights?
Well, I mean, I think this is comes to the heart of what the licensing scheme is about, is that if you were to shoot a golden eagle on land that wasn't the subject of a 16AA licence, the only sanction against that could be applied would be a criminal sanction, which would require, as I say, the sort of the criminal standard of proof, a conviction, and so on, and all the attendant difficulties I outlined earlier. The issue here on a grouse moor is that where that event happens, and the police are able to report to the licensing authority that there definitely has been a crime, the licensing authority are then able to take the view on the balance of probabilities that has been carried out by someone connected with the management of that land and suspend or revoke the licence. So it isn't a double whammy in that way. We're talking about different processes on different sort of pieces of land.
Okay. Is there a difference between revocation and suspension in practice?
Yeah, so suspension could just be for a short period of time. So Nature Scot might find that would be important to suspend a licence, for example, just for a couple of months if they had concerns, to allow the grouse moor to take action and kind of get their house in order. A revocation would be seen as a more permanent thing. So we wanted to have a range of sanctions, with revocation being the most serious, but having the ability to suspend a licence for a short period of time if that was kind of felt to be a more proportionate response rather than a permanent revocation.
OK, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. Ms. Fitzgerald, where in the bill does it say that there's an upper limit on the time that it takes for the investigation?
So we can't put an upper limit on the time it takes for investigation because that is, you know, out with our control. So,
but what if it takes a year and that individual has had a licence suspended for a year without even evidence of, for example, a dead bird, And has their livelihood taken away?
So it wouldn't have been suspended if there wasn't evidence that that criminal activity had taken place and that it was an active investigation, but that will be where Nature Scot will absolutely be keeping in contact with the police to ensure that they're not having that suspension if there's a change in the investigation. So can
I be clear here? So is an official investigation triggered if, we'll say it's a vexatious claim, even if there isn't evidence of, for example, a dead bird?
There would need to be evidence that a relevant crime had been committed and that it had been committed by someone in connection with the grouse moor. So if police were investigating on that basis, if they were just investigating, they'd found a dead badger, but there was not that connection, Nature Scot wouldn't be able to suspend the licence in them. So they would need to be assured by Police Scotland that it was a relevant offence and that it was connected with the management of grouse moors.
And just going back to some of the original stuff we talked about, does the government have evidence to suggest that the cause of death is wrapped up persecution, is linked to grouse moors? So obviously the aim of this is to ensure that there's robust evidence and there's a causal link to a specific aim that you're trying to achieve here, which is within other, relevant offences in other bits of legislation, that this is specific, relevant wildlife crime related to grouse moor management. So it's almost as if this is different for those who are operating grouse moors compared to other regulation.
Well, I mean, I think that comes to the heart of why we've brought in this licensing scheme.
But you haven't got evidence. Have you got evidence? Can you tell me categorically that there is evidence to suggest cause of death wrapped up persecution within the evidence that you have? And for example, is that peer-reviewed?
Well, I come back to what I said before. We have evidence of convictions over a period of years. We have evidence which was produced by the Whitfield and Fielding report, and we have other circumstantial evidence over a number of years of dead birds being found on or around grass moors. Now, that is the evidence that we have, that there has been an issue with raptor persecution on some grass moors.
You're saying that this is going to improve that situation?
Yes.
Because you have evidence to suggest that raptor persecution is linked to grass moors?
Yes.
Right. Well, I'll be interested to see that.
In the bill, page 10, paragraph 35, it states suspend a licence if, despite the relevant authority not being satisfied, as mentioned in paragraph B2, there is an official investigation or proceedings. Can you just set out exactly what an official investigation or proceeding is? Because it would read like if we phoned the police and the police were to investigate. What does that actually mean? Because that would suggest that relevant authorities don't need to be satisfied to suspend a licence.
Yeah, well, I mean, that is set out in the bill, where it defines what an official investigation means in subsection 11. It says official investigation means an investigation by the Police Service of Scotland and so on. For consideration of the question of prosecution, no offence is alleged to have been committed. So it would be for the police to inform the licensing authority that they were investigating a crime, and it would be, as I said earlier, for the licensing authority to decide whether or not to suspend in the light of how serious they considered those offences to be. So it wouldn't be a routine thing where the police were investigating that Nature Scot would immediately suspend the licence. But I think there would be circumstances where it might appear to be entirely unacceptable for a business to carry on if particularly egregious offences had been apparently been committed on that land. So those are the sort of circumstances. And I come back to this point about we would expect them as a public authority to behave reasonably in those circumstances.
I suppose that's, again, it's the word of the law and... someone taking a video of someone with a shotgun pointing up in the air might be enough to trigger a police investigation, and that that would result in a suspension of the licence, even if the relevant authority were not satisfied?
No, it could result in a suspension. No, it not would, it could.
Or could.
Could.
Okay. Christine Graham.
Just back to, somebody might not call the police, they might call the SSPCA, for example. What's the interaction between the SSPCA and the police in these circumstances?
Well, I mean, the SSPCA don't have the power to investigate those sort of crimes, and people should phone the police in the first instance, and I would expect the SSPCA to advise people to do that or themselves to report the matter to the police.
Thank you. Just to clarify that on the record. Thank you.
I think we need clarity as a committee, because could and would isn't yes or no. Does it or doesn't it? Yeah. Yes.
Could is discretion.
I think,
we need clearer.
Well, that's what it means.
It could.
I think we've got reasonable doubt whether that's something we need to do or consider as a stage one report. I think we're probably not going to get any more. And there's nothing more within the legislation about a could or a would. But that's on record. Thank you. Christine, would you like to ask your further question, please?
Sort of debating could and would. Which one is it, please? Page? Oh, dear. Maybe you should...
Oh, Chris, we could come back to you.
What's it about? And I can just ask it. Oh, the Code of Practice. Yes, I now know what it is. Thank you very much. What's the justification of a Code of Practice when you've got licensing already?
A
statutory code of practice. Thank you, pardon.
Code of practice was a recommendation of the Werity Review, which the Scottish Government accepted. So it will just set out the best practice that people who are operating these businesses should adhere to. And that will be something that the licensing authority will be able to take into account when they're making decisions about the granting of the licence.
You don't think it's overkill? Oh, shouldn't have used that expression. You don't think it's over the top?
No, I think it's important, as Werity said, to set out. So the Werity Review looked at a number of issues in relation to grouseware management, such as the use of medicated grit, and recommended that there should be a code of practice drawn up in relation to the use of these products. So we think it's appropriate that we should set out that best practice. And, you know, we already have, for example, a code of practice on Muirburn, and codes of practice that exist in other areas of wildlife management or countryside or agriculture. So it's not without precedent at all.
What's the status of a code of practice in any proceedings in court?
Well, the primary purpose of the code of practice in this particular legislation is that the licensing authority will take account, they will have regard to how much or otherwise an applicant has complied with the code of practice.
So it's just have regard, it's persuasive, is it, rather than determinative?
Yeah, I mean, I think the code of practice will, like most of these codes of practice, have a range of recommendations. There will be those things which you absolutely must comply with, which are legal requirements. There are those things which you really should comply with, and there are those other things which it would be good practice to and may or may not apply to your particular business. So it won't be a question of saying you must do all of these all of the time. Yeah. There will be some of the things which you must do all the time, but there will be other things. So if, for example, a business was continually ignoring best practice recommendations which they could apply, they could comply with, I think the licensing authority would be entitled to say, you know, we think you should be doing this, and can you explain why you're not? This would be good environmental management. And so it's that sort of extent to which the licensing authority will be having regard to the code of practice in taking licensing decisions.
And if someone didn't comply regularly, didn't take advice, that might be have a determination on their licence, might it?
It could do.
Thank you.
Jess.
Thanks, Jimmy. Line of questioning. I would be interested to know why you made that choice, a little bit more detail on why you chose to put have regard to as opposed to something stronger like comply with in case of the code of practice. I'd also be interested to hear what kind of evidence a licence holder would need to present in order to show that they have had regard to the code of practice, and then also what your thinking is on how compliance with the code of practice will be monitored. So 3 points there.
Well, I think the first point about requiring absolute compliance does mean then that it would have to be a one-size-fits-all code, because there are clearly businesses of different sizes, different geographical locations and different sort of resources at their disposal and so on. So we recognise that it will not, a code will not fit everyone. In terms of what evidence would they have to supply, I think it would be more the other way around, that NatureScot will be saying, well, it's been brought to our attention that you don't or comply in certain key respects. We're not asking people to set out every single thing they've done in order to comply with the code. And I think that comes, you know, down to the sort of enforcement point in that NatureScot would, I mean, that they're not going to be a police force, they're not going to be out investigating people's businesses and so on, but they will be, they have area staff, they have people who have particular expertise in particular areas who will report back and report concerns. There will be NGOs, there will be members of the public who will report concerns and so on. So it's that, by those sort of means, that the breaches of the code of practice would come to light, I think.
Okay, thanks.
Can I just ask, is the code of practice going to be developed alongside this bill, and as you hear evidence coming forward, or is it going to be not until after the bill's passed that the code of practice will be, it'll be clear what it is?
It is, development of it is already underway, and I would hope that there will be a draft of some description to be available to the committee at some stage during the passage of the bill.
Thank you very much. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener. We're going to move on to rural economy impacts and property rights. Now, clearly, there are two sides to this argument as we go through the process, as there usually is. And the policy memorandum states that the bill is compliant with the European Convention of Human Rights. So how did the Scottish Government come to the conclusion in its business and regulatory impact assessment that there was little or no impact on those businesses that comply with existing law? And how would it seek to reassure rural estates that are raising concerns about the prospect of additional administrative financial burden associated with a licensing?
Well, I think the first point to make, Mr. Fairley, is that we are very clear that the licensing process will be not bureaucratic, it won't be burdensome, and it will be the minimum required to operate the licence. So we are envisaging a system where people can apply for a licence quite easily, and the presumption will be that they will get the licence unless there is some reason not to. They won't need to make a case for why they should get the licence. So the licence will be, you know, I have or I manage a piece of land on which wish to take grouse, and provision of some basic information around where is that land, how do you describe it on a map, who is responsible for it, who do we contact, and maybe some basic information around what basically is the nature of your business on that land.
Okay.
And that will be it. So we're not, I don't really go along with the idea that this is going to be a burdensome requirement on businesses.
Okay, going back to the convener's previous point, though, if we're looking for a code of conduct in order to facilitate a licence, will it be a prerequisite to have the code of conduct in place before the licence is granted?
Yeah, before this scheme is launched, the code of practice will be available, yes.
And that code of practice, I presume, is being worked up with stakeholders?
Yes.
It is. Okay, thank you, convener.
The code of practice, would non-compliance with the code of practice potentially result in an applicant being refused a licence?
Potentially. Again, I don't think this would be a routine occurrence, but I think where there was persistent failure to comply for no good reason, the licensing authority would be entitled to say, well, we're not going to give you a licence for that activity.
Okay. Rachel Hamilton.
Just a simple question. Is the bill compliant with the ECHR?
Well, yes. I mean, as far as we're concerned, as you know, Scottish Government is obliged by law to comply with ECHR, and we look at these things very carefully, as do the presiding officer of the Parliament. Their staff also look very carefully, but I don't know if, Norman, you want to add anything to that?
Just to say that the Scottish Government has very carefully considered the ECHR implications of the provisions of the bill, and the Scottish Government's position is that it is compliant with the ECHR and consequently is within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament.
So just going back to the discussion that we've been having there about suspension of licensing without any evidence of wrongdoing, is that compatible with ECHR?
The provisions in relation to suspension would not be that there is no evidence of wrongdoing. There would need to be some evidence of there being wrongdoing in order for there to be for the licensing authority who will, whether or not it's Nature Scot or whether or not it's the Scottish ministers, would need to be compliant with ECHR in their conduct. And so they would, taking that into account, would be able to suspend the licence, but they would only be doing so, as Hugh mentioned earlier, in circumstance, and it would be circumstance dependent, and it would depend on the egregiousness of the offence that's ongoing, for example.
Okay, to put it in sort of layman's terms, can you give examples of what you mean by some evidence of wrongdoing, so that it is compliant with Article 1, Protocol 1 of the ECHR?
In order for there to be a suspension of a licence, there would need to be, firstly, evidence of a relevant offence having been committed, and secondly, there would need to be a causal link.
Such as
an example may be an animal or a wild bird found on the land, for example, to give that as an example. And secondly, there would need to be a causal connection that is to the satisfaction of the relevant authority that the causal connection between that offence and the licence holder in order to justify going down the route of exercising the power to suspend a licence. It is a power, it's not a mandatory if there's an investigation. Therefore, the suspension must occur, and it's something that would be a question of degree, and it would be for the licensing authority to determine based on the circumstances of each case-by-case basis.
So just to go back to what is the difference between suspension and revocation?
Certainly. The position with revocation is that revocation may occur where the licensing authority is satisfied on the balance of probabilities that an offence has been committed. So this would likely be where the investigation has concluded. Suspension, there is also a power to suspend and not revoke where an investigation is ongoing, and the definition of official investigation is provided for in the bill. And so as I think Hugh and Leah mentioned earlier on, it is a question of degree in that there are options open to the licensing authority in determining what action to take. They may modify a licence to put additional conditions. They may go down the route of suspending a licence depending on what has occurred in the circumstances, or if the person who's involved in the ownership or management of the land in question has been convicted of a relevant offence, then they may take the last resort route of revoking the licence in those circumstances. But it's a power, it's not a mandatory requirement of the licensing authority to do so in those circumstances.
So to be compliant with the ECHR protocol, it means that if there's a vexatious complaint, that there has to be an immediate investigation and evidence to suggest that there has been wrongdoing.
The licensing authority will be a public authority and so will be required to, when going about their conduct, do so in such a way that is compliant with ECHR. And so any investigation that takes place would similarly need to be compliant with ECHR.
Okay.
I think this is an area that we could spend an awful lot of time on. So there's issues around civil burden of proof and how that would react, and also whether, even if Nature Scot decides that a licence shouldn't be revoked, it's suspended, even if a court doesn't. So there's some difficulties there, just understanding how that will engage with the European Court of Human Rights. I think we'll probably write for more clarification exactly on that, because it's quite clear there's some dubiety in our minds about Nature Scot's ability to suspend, or in the situation where a police investigation would effectively result in the suspension of a licence. But we'll return to that. I think the committee will write rather than explore at the moment. I think there's certainly in my mind there's still some difficulties to get my head around. We'll move on from that if you don't mind at the moment, and we'll move on to our next question from Alistair Allen. Oh, Alistair, I think we've covered it. Karen Adam, beg your pardon.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to question around the rationale for a regulation, and could you tell us what evidence there was to the extent of what wildlife traps are used in Scotland and any associated impacts on animal welfare and biodiversity?
Well, there's a range of traps which are used in Scotland. Specifically, the traps which are typically used around grass moor management are traps to catch, spring traps, to catch stoats and weasels in particular, and also then traps to catch wild birds, which would be larsen traps or crow cage traps, would be the main sort of traps which would be in use. Those traps have a legitimate purpose, and they can be, and most usually are used perfectly legally and perfectly correctly. However, they can also sometimes be used to catch protected species, and they can also sometimes catch other non-target species unintentionally. So that's the sort of the risk, and the Werity recommendations were really about reducing that risk so that traps would be operated by those people who were trained to do so and who were able to, you know, those traps were able to be identified with a particular person who'd set them, so there'd be that sort of chain of accountability. So that's really, I think, okay, where we're coming from with the sort of wildlife trapping provisions.
Can I ask how the spring traps that you mentioned, and also there's live capture bird traps.
Yeah.
What was the conclusion that was made that required this additional regulation?
Well, I think it was the potential for those to be misused, okay, really. So the live capture traps have been used in the past to capture raptors. Again, there is good evidence of that. There is video evidence. There is convictions and so on. And also sometimes spring traps have been abused also to catch raptors. For example, the fen trap was used. It's no longer a lawful trap, but when it was used, placed on top of a pole, and so that if a raptor sort of came down to perch on the pole, the trap would close on the raptor's legs, right, and it would be sort of caught there and die a pretty grisly death there, trapped on top of a pole. So those were the sort of impacts that had been happening. I'm not saying that they were typical, but they had been happening, and there were convictions for them, and so really this was about addressing that, but also I think generally seeking to improve animal welfare outcomes when these traps are used lawfully, to ensure that the highest sort of standards apply, and that people are operating to those high standards as delivered by training courses, and that there is, to say, that accountability through those traps being identified and registered with the authorities.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, beg your pardon, sorry. I had a supplementary from Marianne Burgess. Sorry, Alison.
Ms. Convener, just picking up on that point you made about training. So the requirements for trap operators to complete training is similar to the approach that the government has implemented for the use of snares. And some respondents noted in their evidence that the more than 3,000 individuals who have undergone the training to operate snares, only 3 have failed. How will this legislation ensure the training programmes are robust and effective at ending bad practice?
Well, we or Nature Scot will approve the training course, and we will look to see that there is sort of high compliance with those training courses. I think I guess it's not difficult to pass these courses if one pays attention. I suppose the key thing is, does that person then continue to apply that level of skill and knowledge and practice in their daily work? And I guess that's sort of really the sort of key issue, and that I guess is where the sort of you know, the registration part of it comes in. But yes, I mean, it is important that we ensure that these courses are effective and delivering the right standard of training.
Thanks.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you could explain one point, please, around licences. There does appear to be a distinction between wildlife trap licences, as I understand this, and Section 16AA licences, in that one has an appeal process and the other doesn't, if I have that right. So I wonder if you could explain the reasons behind that distinction, please.
Well, I think the sort of primary reason is the level of impact of the sanction. So, you know, we are very much aware that suspension or revocation of a 16AA licence would have a significant impact on a business, and I mean, that's really the purpose of it. And for that reason, yes, we do think an appeal to the sheriff is justified. But I think around this sort of area, the sort of internal processes in NatureScot are sufficient in the way that most of their licensing regimes operate.
Thank you.
I just wanted to very quickly go back to the licensing. I want to make sure I'm not going to step on any of my colleagues' toes. The duration of the licence, 1 year, what's the thoughts around that? And would it not give more certainty and reduce the workload of NatureScot if it was a multi-year licence?
Well, the one-year licence, I suppose, reflects the fact that it is a seasonal activity, and it's very similar to most of the licences that NatureScot operate are for a year, occasionally for 2 years. But I think the sort of key issue here really is that, as I say, this is not going to be a difficult licence to obtain or a difficult licence to renew. It won't involve a significant process or workload for the applicant. And I guess also the fact that it is on a yearly basis does enable the licensing authority to have a clearer understanding of what is actually happening across the country over a period of years, so that they understand where these sort of activities are going on and how those businesses are operating.
But is it in the public interest to have an annual licence when there's maybe no evidence that things have changed? It also takes away some certainty on investment in Grasmere's. Is it really worth an annual review or an annual process? I know you're saying it's simple, but is it really needed?
Well, I think it was, you know, that was our judgment, that would be the appropriate level for it. But I guess, you know, with all of these things, that there are counter-arguments, and we're always open to hearing those.
OK, thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask how the government is going to respond to concerns from land managers that tampering with legally set traps could mean individuals are vulnerable to prosecution. And is there current evidence that this is a significant issue in relation to legally set traps?
Well, I mean, that is the position right now, that there is the risk that someone could be prosecuted because of someone tampering with a trap. I'm not aware that's ever happened. I know it's a... I'm not aware there's ever been a prosecution of someone. I'm sorry, Evan.
Yeah, no, I'm listening.
Yeah. So we are aware that there are frequent claims that there is tampering, and we hear that regularly from land managers, that people do tamper with legally set snares and other traps. And we are also advised that there are already offences that apply to this, that those are criminal activities. So I'm not really certain how anything in this legislation is going to alter that basic picture.
OK, that was the point I was wanting to come on to. If there is evidence of somebody illegally tampering with a trap or setting a trap illegally for someone else to catch the fall for, is there a method of prosecuting those individuals who are carrying out that activity?
Though we are certainly advised by the Crown and by the police that those are potentially crimes, yes.
OK. Could we get clarification on what that is and how it could be enacted?
I think, yes, I mean, there's no doubt that it is potentially a criminal offence to tamper with a trap. Mm. There are, as always with these things, in the same way as it's difficult to identify and prosecute people for rapt persecution, it's also difficult to identify and prosecute people for tampering with a trap.
I accept that fully. But if we could just get some clarification on what would be the, what is the illegal activity and how it would be prosecuted.
I think malicious mischief has been mentioned as one of the potential offences. It's a common law offence. And also, I think criminal damage is another potential offence. But again, we're probably better getting evidence from the Crown or from the police on that.
Yeah, if you could come back to us, that would be grand. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
I just need some clarification as well, Convener, on Mr Dignan's response to Jim Fairley there on the there's no evidence of trap interfering, tampering or sabotage.
No, I didn't say that.
What
I said there's no evidence of anyone being prosecuted.
Prosecuted, yeah, okay. So you will accept that there are individuals who are concerned that there are traps being interfered and sabotaged with. And has that been reflected in the response call to evidence so far? Has the Bill team picked that up?
It's been mentioned. It's mentioned. We have frequent meetings with land managers, gamekeepers in particular, have expressed their concern around this over a number of years. And I can perfectly well see the risk. My point was that I wasn't aware that anybody had been prosecuted in a circumstance where they said that their trap had been tampered with.
Okay, so that sort of speaks to the same approach that you're taking to Grasmore licensing. Should there be a bespoke offence in it, you know, alone for tampering, sabotage and interference of traps?
Well, as I understand it, the issue is not the lack of an offence. The issue is the lack of the difficulty in securing a prosecution in identifying...
So are you saying there's a lack of evidence, which is exactly the same approach that the Grasmore licence...
No, I'm not saying there's a lack of evidence. I'm saying there's a lack of... There's a difficulty in... If a trap has been tampered with, in saying, who did that? Identifying them beyond reasonable doubt. That's the problem.
Suggestion that there could be a tougher way to deal with this than a malicious mischief, and perhaps there is a need for a specific crime to be within this bill to send a message out that tampering with traps is absolutely unacceptable. That's something. Given the response from the call from Views, it is a significant concern to gamekeepers that traps have been tampered with, so it may be something to consider as an amendment at stage two, that we need a specific offence rather than rely on other pieces of law, which you appear to suggest that the law is not sufficient to prosecute those who are tampering with.
I'm not saying there's a deficiency with the offence. I'm saying that there is a problem with gathering sufficient evidence to prosecute.
So maybe a change in legislation would address that, the burden of proof or whatever. No. I'm not. I just want clarity. Do you think there'll be any grounds to make a clear offence within this bill, which then made it easier to prosecute those who were tampering with traps?
I think that's something we can discuss with the police and with the Crown Prosecution Service, whether they feel that it would help them or whether there's a need for a specific offence. So that's something we'll continue speaking with our stakeholders about.
Yeah, thank you. Sorry, I had no intention of putting words in your mouth. I just wanted some clarity on whether there was maybe an improvement we could have within the bill. Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd be interested to know what the key issues are. This is on SPCA powers. I'd be interested to know what the key issues are the Scottish Government needs to come to a view in order to make a decision about extending SPCA powers. And is the Scottish Government working with Police Scotland to consider this?
The answer is yes, we will be announcing a position on that shortly. You'll be aware that there has been a review carried out of this by Susan Davis, who led a task force to look at it. I think the issues are pretty well understood, that the SSPCA have some additional resources they could bring to bear in tackling wildlife crime. However, there are concerns that... That they may not be sufficiently neutral as a charity, and there may also be concerns that they may in some way undermine the primacy of Police Scotland as the main law enforcement agency for tackling wildlife crime. So those are the key sort of issues. I guess one of the other issues that does come up quite often is the timeliness of gathering evidence and so on, in that often SSPCA will find themselves in a location investigating something under their existing powers, and they may have been able to seize evidence but were not able to do so under their current powers. So those are the sort of issues that ministers are looking at, and I think we would be able to come to a conclusion that very soon. And the same way as the snaring provisions, we would certainly get any change that ministers want to make to the current position to the committee along the same sort of timescales as those for the snaring the snaring provisions. Excuse me. It's water.
Could you give any examples of the kinds of cases SSPCA have usefully assisted Police Scotland with in the past?
I don't have sort of specific cases to hand, but yes, I mean the SSPCA have reported cases to the Crown on numerous occasions, and those have led to successful prosecutions. So I think it goes without saying that under their existing powers, they have carried out useful and effective investigations.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Turning to...
Christine Graham.
What's the most of the time, convener? I wanted to ask you, what are the current limitations on the SSPCA investigating anything, where they must actually just stop? And what is being in consideration in which way to extend those powers?
Yeah. Well, I mean, primarily, their powers are to do with animal welfare. So they are able to investigate cases where an animal is in distress. So, for example, if there was an animal in a trap and it was suffering, that would clearly be within their powers. I suppose what wouldn't be within their powers would be if there was next to that animal suffering in a trap, there was a dead animal in another trap, so there'd be no suffering involved. So that wouldn't be within their powers. Or if there was a trap that was unlawfully set, but no animal in it at all, that also wouldn't be within their powers to investigate that. So it's where there is an animal that is suffering, that's the primary thing about where their powers lie at present.
Which must seem to the public a bit odd that the example, which I'm not saying has really happened, but you've one animal that's suffering, one animal that's dead beside each other, the SSPCA can be involved with one but not with the other.
That's the current position. Yeah.
Can I ask, therefore, and I know this is just under consideration, it seems that you've mentioned now, I think you're suggesting amendment at stage two, possibly, whereas what we have in our briefing is that this would be brought in by affirmative procedure.
Yeah.
So what process are we looking at here? And I appreciate affirmative procedure means evidence and so on, but can you advise why...
The current provisions which are in the bill are there to ensure that we can, if we wish,
yes,
bring forward.
Understand.
But I think if we are going to make a change, and it's not been decided yet, ministers will take the final view on that. But I think that will be fairly imminent. Then we will bring forward specific provisions if we do decide to do something further with SSPCA powers. There will be provisions that will be explicit about that on the face of the bill.
Which is better, in my view, in primary legislation.
Yeah.
Can I ask, therefore, as I asked before about snaring, if it's possible for even a draft of the amendment to be before this committee during our stage one contemplation, whether or not that's its final form, it gives a steer that anybody else in the committee might take a view, indeed the government might change it, somebody in the committee might take a view to actually amend the proposed amendment in one way or the other.
That is our intention, as it was with snaring, to do that.
Thank you.
Sorry about that. Just covering for the convener for a few minutes. Can I bring in Rhoda Grant on question 13 on Muirburn?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to ask why there are two different types of Mewburn licence, one for peatland and one for other areas.
Yeah. Well, it's not so much that there are two different types of licence, that they are, there is a Mewburn licence, but the Mewburn licence for burning on peatland will be subject to a higher degree of scrutiny, and there are more stringent restrictions on when it will be granted in terms of the depth of the peat and so on. And that is because we perceive that there is a greater sort of risk of environmental damage through burning on peatland.
Okay. I mean, people always ask us about bureaucracy and simplifying things. It seems to me that a lot of people may need a Mewburn licence and a Mewburn licence on peat. So they would be needing to apply for two, potentially for two licences to carry out the one exercise. Is there a way that this could be more simplified to make it more straightforward in practice for people to apply for licences?
Well, a Mewburn licence will apply to a piece of land. So the land manager will say, I want to burn on this piece of land, or maybe I want to burn on all of these pieces of land across an estate, and the licensing authority will need to be assessing whether or not any of that land is peatland. The applicant will be asked, is any of this land peatland? If it is peatland, specific requirements will apply to that. So I don't think there is any prospect of having... clearly we want to ensure that there is a higher degree of scrutiny and a higher degree of control over burning on peatland because of the greater environmental risks. I don't think it's a matter of having two licences. It would be a matter of having a licence which allowed burning on peatland if that's what you wanted to do. Or if you weren't burning on peatland, the licence wouldn't have those same requirements attaching to it.
So if it's a mixed licence between peatland and non-peatland, you would need a peatland licence?
Yes. You would certainly need to meet the requirements of the peatland licence, for burning on peatland, yes.
Okay. But it would be just... Sorry, I'm trying... sounds like I'm not following you, but... No. So you would only have one licence, but within that licence you would have a licence... You would be allowed to burn on peatland? Or do you... I'm trying to really get to whether you need two different licences.
You won't need two licences for any one piece of land. So, I mean, you would need, if the land you wish to burn on was falls within the definition of peatland, the licence would be a licence for burning on peat.
And if it was mixed?
Well, if you had, I'm not sure, were you going to say that?
It would depend on the purpose. So there are more purposes for which you're permitted to do muir burn on non-peatland. So if you were, for example, wanting to undertake muir burn for preventing wildfires, then you might only need to apply for one licence because that's a purpose that is shared between muir burn and non-muir burn. So it would depend upon the land that you're burning on and the purpose. But we would be looking to work with stakeholders to, as we have with all of our other licensing schemes, to develop the licence. And it may be that one licence application would be able to be designed in a way that could capture different purposes, or that's something we would seek to work with stakeholders and get their feedback into how the licence application should look and the level of information, and whether it would be better to have, as you said, one licence that could capture multiple purposes on different types of land, or whether stakeholders actually would prefer to be able to have distinct licences. So that's something that we'll work with stakeholders to develop in more detail.
That would be useful, because I'm just thinking crofter on a small croft, part of it with people and part not, having to kind of get involved in all of this bureaucracy, having to identify which land is peatland, measuring the peat depth and all of that, that just seems to me really complicated, and I suppose then leads to the concern, do people apply for licences or not, especially for small areas of ground.
I mean, I think, you know, the key point is that different consideration will be applied to peatland. Apart from, as Leah says, where the purpose is prevention of wildfire. But, I mean, we are aware that there is a significantly higher environmental risk, potentially, through burning on peat. And so we do need to have different considerations for that. And whether we can combine that in a single licence or whether there would need to be one licence for the peat bit and one for the non-peat bit, I think, is a matter of working that out, as Leah says, with stakeholders and the licensing authority.
OK, so this will come in secondary legislation. Will it be affirmative?
I'm not sure it's affirmative, is it? I don't think so.
No, so the development and licensing scheme, so that will be developed, obviously. Nature Scotland will start working on that now, but as they did with the hunting with dogs, once the we've got the kind of final shape of the legislation, then they will sit down with stakeholders and then they will begin the process of designing the application forms and the guidance that goes along with the application form. So they'll start those discussions now, but obviously it'll have to be after the legislation is enacted before the final shape of the licence can be determined, because that will be determined by what's finally in the legislation. But that's part of their sort of inbuilt process that they, when a new licensing scheme is developed, they will sit down with stakeholders and they'll be involved in the design process of it.
But will that come back to the Parliament as secondary legislation?
No, because everything that is in the licence and all the requirements of the licensing scheme will be set out as they are at the moment on the face of the bill. And then the detail of it, you know, what the boxes are, what the information that they're asking for, all of that is what's then taken forward. So there's not a need to have legislation for that. That's, as with other licensing schemes, that's done after the event in conjunction with stakeholders.
Thank you. As others have said, there are different purposes for which licences can be granted according to whether it's peatland or non-peatland. I notice amongst the reasons that can be offered for burning on non-peatland is to manage the environment, but that's not, am I right in saying, one of the reasons for applying to burn on peatland, where you can offer to enhance the environment but not to manage it. I may be reading it wrong. I wonder if you could explain that point about the reasons that people can offer. And also, if you maybe say a bit about what it is that you're trying to prevent as an outcome by people burning on peatland. I mean, I know there have been examples in England in the past of wildfires where it is alleged that peat has burned on a hillside, although it's difficult maybe to point to examples of that in Scotland, I'm not sure. But can you say a bit more? That's the other half of my question, is what is it that you're trying to prevent by people burning on peatland?
Okay. But in terms of the purposes, under 10.2b are a subset of the purposes under 10.2a. So there are clearly a wider range of purposes. So, for example, restoring the natural environment, which is available as a purpose under where the licence applies to peatland, would be a subset of the ones under 10.2a3, which has restoring as part of it, but not obviously conserving, enhancing and managing are not those which apply to the peatland. So it's a narrower set. So basically, where it's peatland, we have envisaged that there may be circumstances where a landowner was of the view that in order to restore or repair the land, that Muirburn was the right way to go, and if that was agreed with Nature Scotland, that's what this particular provision is about. But it doesn't allow burning on peatland isn't permitted for the wider range of purposes which are set out in 10.2a. So that's really what
it is.
I suppose
the other half of my question is why? Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, I mean, I think the first thing to say is that this is clearly an area where there's a lot of contested science, and we're not really settling on a particular view over whether or not burning on peatland is necessarily damaging. What we are saying is there is a risk of serious carbon emission through burning which damages the peat. So there's a risk of peat degrading and emitting. There's also a risk of the peat itself catching fire, which again would cause catastrophic carbon emissions and also could be a serious long-term issue to deal with. So those are the sort of risks which we're seeking to mitigate here. But again, I would just say it's not settled science. We appreciate that. And for that reason, the provisions in this section around Muirburn are subject to order-making power, so allow us to sort of adjust the purposes for which mule ban may be carried out, and also to adjust the definition of what is peatland and what is not.
Thank you.
I thought there was a supplementary note. May we move on to Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Some stakeholders have, so this is around wildfires, some stakeholders have raised concerns that the purpose of making Muir Burn to manage wildfire risk on peatland will become a loophole. How will a need for Muir Burn to manage wildfire risk on peatlands be assessed?
Well, again, you know, in the first point, is that wildfire clearly is a serious risk. We're seeing that now with fires at the moment in the north of Scotland, and we envisage that that will clearly only get more difficult with ongoing climate change. So we're absolutely certain that that needs to be in there. In terms of whether or not it's a loophole, well, again, this will be for the licensing authority to determine. I think the licensing authority will be trying to follow the latest science. They will need to be au fait with actually what's happening on the ground, and they will also, I think, need to be taking advice from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And I think, you know, the Scottish Government will clearly be very influenced in their advice on this too. But it will be a matter of, essentially, at the end of the day, for the licensing authority to decide where wildfire management or wildfire risk is best managed by Muir Burn, and the extent of that Muir Burn which is necessary to manage that wildfire risk, if that is put forward as the primary purpose for burning. Sam, who knows more about this, may want to add anything on this.
Yeah, well, I think the key thing is what Hugh said about the work with Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So I know that Nature Scott, as alongside the guidance, they'll also be working with stakeholders on the code of practice. So working with the stakeholders will be a key part of it.
Okay, thanks. And just to follow up, the Muir Burn, so on the Muir Burn season outlined in the bill runs until the 15th of April. This overlaps with the start of the breeding season for many moorland bird species, such as curlew, whose nests could be threatened by Muir Burn. Has the government given consideration to bringing forward the end date of the Muir Burn season, such as to the 15th of March, to protect threatened species?
Well, I think this is something which can be amended in the future, and certainly we would not want to see curlew nesting being in any way threatened by Muir Burn, and if there is evidence that that is indeed the case, I think we'd be happy to look at that, as indeed I'm sure Nature Scott would. Again, Sam, do you have any further thought on that?
I guess just to point out that there is also an order-making power, so that could be amended without needing primary legislation.
Great, thanks very much.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. It's about the Muir Burn Code. Some stakeholders have questioned why licensees must have regard to the code rather than comply with the code. So why have you chosen this wording? And how will it be determined that a person has had regard to the Muir Burn Code?
Well, again, I think it comes back to the same sort of considerations when we were talking about the Grouse Moor Management Code, is that the code will contain a mixture of requirements, some of which will be compulsory. It's the law that you must do X or Y. Some which will be highly recommended in terms of, for example, record keeping and so on. And some which may only apply in certain circumstances in certain parts of the country, depending on the underlying topography or in terms of the size of the burns or any other consideration.
I'll just add to that Nature Scott do have the power to put conditions on the licence, so they could, for example, make it a condition that the person must comply with section 1 of the code if that was deemed appropriate.
Thank you.
Christine Graham.
Yeah, back to, I think, a question that we raised before, was there's concerns over the ability to suspend urban licences where there's, in quotes, an official investigation or proceedings in relation to an offence under this part. Could you give clarity, perhaps, to what is an official investigation and what are proceedings?
My colleague just drawing my attention to the definition, which is in 13.7.
Well, I should have known that. There we are, right over the knuckles. 13.7, what's the definition?
An official investigation means an investigation by the Police Service of Scotland
or any other body that has one of its functions reporting for consideration of the question of prosecution offences alleged to have been committed.
Can it be just triggered by a complaint? It has to be. That would not be
no,
proceedings.
It has to be an investigation by the
police.
It
has to be an official police investigation, yes. Where people are advised that this is happening. Thank yep. you. What about the official investigation? Sorry, I'm getting muddling myself now. Don't muddle you up. Official investigation must be the police.
Or any other body that has any one other of its body, functions reporting. So.
Proceedings. What are proceedings then? Or proceedings?
Proceedings are criminal proceedings.
So they're actually live. Somebody's been served with a charge.
Yes, that's correct.
Thank you. That's me.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you. There was a variety of views among stakeholders amongst this figure of 40 centimetres depth of peat, and again, why that figure had been chosen. So can you tell us why that figure had been chosen, please?
Well, again, it's one of the sort of much debated issues in this area. There is at present, there's 50 centimetres is in the code of practice. There are people arguing that it should be 30. In south of the border, 40 is applied in protected areas. So we really were sought to balance out some of these arguments and to take what we thought was a precautionary approach. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that has been the underlying principle in all of our work on Muirburn and the provisions that you see now in the bill is recognising that this is an area of significant concern. Potentially there are big issues at stake in terms of carbon emissions, but there are also big issues at stake in terms of effective management for grazing and other sort of agricultural purposes. And so we've sought to sort of try to balance that, taking where possible the precautionary approach so that, you know, we are minimising the potential risk to the environment, certainly while this ongoing scientific debate goes on around the effects of Muirburn, around the effects of Muirburn on carbon emission and on damage to peat and so on. So these are ongoing debates and we want to be able to react accordingly in the future. But in the meantime, we think that 40 centimetres represents a practical, pragmatic approach to setting a depth for peat where our controls will apply.
On that point you make there about precautionary principle, I appreciate the need to restore peatland. I don't dispute that. But again, I come back to this point I was asking about before. Is the scenario that we are envisaging here when we're talking about carbon emissions,
yep.
the carbon from vegetation, or is this posited on the idea that peatland burns on the hill?
Well, it's both. I mean, what we absolutely, I mean, clearly there will be some carbon emissions from the burning of vegetation. The key risk, though, is to prevent carbon emissions from exposing or burning the peat.
Right. Is there evidence, though, that there have been wildfires in Scotland where peat has burned on the hill?
I believe so, yes.
Right. My other question was, and it was, others have raised this, really, but how do you measure an area which might have wildly varying topography? Rhoda Grant asked this, really, herself, yeah. but... How does somebody go about measuring a few acres of land where there might be wildly varying depths of peat?
Yes, I recognise that. I mean, I know that can indeed be the case. And that will be for NatureScot to promulgate a methodology. It'll be something which they are developing and will develop further. It's something which is... there is already a methodology which is used south of the border around protected areas, but I think we will seek to make it simple and not a complicated matrix or formula that anyone has to follow, but it will probably involve assessing depths with a pole in a number of spots over a given area and then determining what that means the average depth will be. Again, I don't know if you want to add anything, Sam.
Yeah, just as well as being used south of the border, it's also used in a number of other activities. So for the peatland code, there's currently sort of guidance out there in terms of how you can measure the depth of peat in across the land. It's also used for wind turbine developments, and there's also another one which is escaping my mind at the moment, but there's already methodologies and guidance out there for conducting the surveys.
Thank you.
Just on that, will there be an area of peat over 40 centimetres that needs to be achieved before a licence is required? So is it half an acre, is it 3 acres or whatever? And is there not a risk, unless these areas are looked at in detail, that someone could inadvertently not apply for the right licence because the peat in some areas of their estate is 40 centimetres?
There is a requirement for a proportionate approach here, and NatureScot will take that sort of approach, that a piece of ground which has a pocket or two which are over 40 centimetres would clearly, it would not be sensible to include those within the definition of peatland. So, you know, as in the response to Mr. Allen, there will be a methodology for assessing land and the amount of area of land over a particular depth will clearly be one of those key considerations.
The problem is a proportionate will have a completely different meaning to someone from RSPB, for example, to someone who's managing a grouse moor. So the legislation, does it not need to actually set out that rather than just have proportionate?
Yeah, well, it won't be RSPB or someone who's managing it who will decide what's proportionate. It'll be NatureScot will decide what is the proportionate approach.
OK, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Can I just, again, clarify this point? What size of area defines peatland in the government's definition?
Geographical area?
Yeah,
well, I mean,
what
I think
area?
That's what we've just been talking about
what's a number on it? Can you quantify it?
I'm not sure what you're asking me. I mean, in terms of that we have a 40 centimetre figure for thickness or depth.
So, no, I mean.
And now we've said that hectares. If that applied across a square metre, clearly that's not relevant. If it applied across a couple of hectares, definitely is relevant. So this would be the proportionality element that NatureScot will come forward with when they develop the methodology for people assessing should your licence be a licence for burning on peatland, or should your licence be just for burning on not on peatland?
So, again, to clarify, are you planning to set a minimum level?
A minimum area?
Yeah, area.
So I think just to come into the methodologies that are currently used, I think it's 100 metres by 100 metres is the sort of grid that's used for the surveys for some of the other, for the peatland code, and there's also forestry was the other area which I forgot about before. So the survey methodologies are already sort of already set out, already being used. It might be that for this there's slight differences in the methodology in terms of what NatureScot decide is proportionate and appropriate. So it's but at the moment there is a sort of 100 metre sort of grid, 100 metre by 100 metre grid that can be placed on the land, and then probes are taken within that to assess where the peat is and where the peat isn't.
If it's helpful, we can provide mm-hmm. more written evidence of the current methodology and how they're applied and how they then are used to determine if an area is peatland or not.
Yeah, obviously, Hugh Dignan said that, you know, the depth will be looked at, but, you know, is it in the public interest to arbitrarily define something that's either 50 centimetres or 40 centimetres? I mean, what is the difference?
Well, as I say, it is by its very nature an arbitrary limit, but it represents, as I say, our best assessment of where the risks lie.
And is that based on, you've talked a number of times, and I quote you talked about environmental risk. So what is the evidence that you've arbitrarily redefined the depth of peatland that would benefit the environment, but also the scientific basis of using Muir Burn as last tool of last resort, as referred to in page 16, with regard to there's no other method of vegetation control available. I mean, what is the scientific basis of that? And would that actually increase the risk of wildfires?
Well, we're saying that the prevention of wildfire is one of the purposes for which Muir Burn and peatland will be permitted.
But what is your scientific basis of that?
So it was restricting Muir Burn on peatland as a recommendation of the Climate Change Committee. So that was obviously something that they looked at, and they brought forward recommendations on that. So we've taken into account the recommendations of Werity, the recommendations of the Climate Change Committee, and all of the available science and the work that we're doing in terms of peatland restoration to come up with what we believe is a proportionate approach, which does allow some burning of peatland in limited circumstances, but allows NatureScot to be able to, you know, consider applications and take all factors into account when deciding whether it's or not it's appropriate to issue a licence.
And you're not concerned that individuals who are in good faith applying for a licence will fall foul of the law if an assessment, a correct assessment, hasn't been made of whether it's peatland, non-peatland, one licence, two licence, not being able to probe an area because it's not practical, and the differing depths?
Well, as Sam said, people already have to measure peatland if they want to do certain developments, so this is not new. So what we are just building on is what exists. There is a methodology, there is already a requirement for people to be able to determine peatland, so this happens already.
Can I just add as well, under the requirement from Muir Burn license, section 9, subsection 3, it says specifically it's not an offence for a person to make Muir Burn on peatland if the Muir Burn license relating to that land specifies that the land is not peatland. So if they've applied for a licence and the licensing authorities agreed that that land is not peatland, if someone later comes along and says, well, actually it is because of X and Y, no offence has been committed because they have the licence that's allowed them to carry out burning on land which is not peatland.
I think just to add to that, we envisage that NatureScot would assess the application, assess the survey work that's been done by the applicant. So if what the applicant says that they have done has been done, then as you said, that wouldn't be an offence, and NatureScot would agree. We think you've done the appropriate level of survey work.
So just one last quick question. Can I get some clarification on the Climate Change Committee's position on this, please, with regards to the evidence that you just gave of using that as your scientific basis? Would you mind?
Thank you.
I think there's some suggestion that Climate Change are actually viewing the position in light of some new evidence that suggested that land that had been Muir Burned actually was carbon positive compared to other methods of vegetation control. So that's certainly something we look at further down. Thank you for that clarification. There was some concern that if we got the licences wrong for peatland or non-peatland Muir Burn, that it could result in criminal proceedings. So that clarification has been very helpful. I wonder whether you would consider a de minimis. So there was a certain, you talked about 100 by 100, that maybe needs to be included in the face of the bill to make sure that some people are not caught up in the legislation, that actually there's no need for them to do. That might be something that we'll consider. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, I have a great deal of sympathy with you this, as far as trying to get a legislation that's going to work here, because you've got livestock considerations, you've got grouse moor considerations, you've got wildlife considerations, and you've got environmental considerations. And this is going to be difficult to get the right balance. I'm not going to ask any more questions. I'm going to think a bit more before I open my mouth.
That's not what politicians
Thank you very much. That has been a hugely useful evidence session. Thank you all very much for your contribution. I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes. I suspend the meeting and we move into private.